SJ 290, which is
Senator.
This wonderful bill that I just.
Senator Rush.
Does it take into consideration federal?
So what it considers is what the courts have held, which is compact, contiguous, and community of common interest, which has been a court standard. It would be applying that criteria and including that in our Constitution.
It would also fully have to be in compliance with voting rights.
Right, and as well as the Voting Rights Act. Yes, it would be in compliance with federal law as well. Yes, Senator Ruff. Okay, so the motion is properly before us. Senator Howell and Vogel's SJ 290, and the motion is to report. All in favor, please vote aye or nay, same sign. And the resolution reports.
Thank
you very much. Hold on, we have an error. The clerk is asking. I'm sorry. Okay, so they were rolled together. Okay, so they were rolled together. I'm sorry. Okay, we have roll call co-patrons. I apologize. Sorry. Okay, Senator Cosgrove.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Now the we had five bills dealing with restoration of rights. And those joint resolutions were 222, which was Senator Locke's bill, 223, which is Senator Norman's bill, 243, which is Senator Edwards' bill, 272, which is Senator Hanger's bill, and 319, which is Senator Locke's bill as well. So, after hearing these and looking at them, we made the motion to roll these bills in as follows. Senate Joint Resolution 222, Senate Joint Resolution 243, Senate Joint Resolution 272, and Senate Joint Resolution 319 to be rolled into Senator Norman's Senate Joint Resolution 223.
Okay, and I just have a question, Senator Cosgrove.
Yes, ma'am.
Sorry, Senator Cosgrove. Because some of these bills I think are good and some I have concerns about, but to be clear, the language, the substance of the bill that you would be making a recommendation on is actually the language of SJR 223.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Is everybody clear about that? The Senator Spruill.
Madam Chair, and then I want to talk about 223. It came off today, and some people were concerned about them putting all the building to one and just getting out of here without an estimation. And some concern about the rights of the governor, and a lot of people, in particular, always concerned about 223 that I'm going to support. Some of them didn't like that, but I want you to hear why. Number one, two, non-violent and violent are not the same. And I really question that if this governor would not be here for the next 20 years, and the next governor come in, we'll be like it was before, that a governor will have the option to restore the rights of a nonviolent versus the violent. This way, at least, the nonviolent will be taken care of if you follow the requirements. It will not be up to a governor. And that's important. Second thing, as far as the substitute, in the original bill, those violents did not have any option at all. The substitute give those who live in violent crime at least an option once they meet all the requirements and through the government. Now, the key is this. some folks, especially some of my colleagues, they were concerned about taking the rights away from the government. And I would say, let me be talking about black folks for a minute. I'm concerned about the way folks are treated. How many governors have we have had all these years who did not do right about black folks? See, so I'm not concerned about taking the rights away from a governor, but I know that this bill, that I may not like it, but this bill helps both nonviolent versus the violent. Violence is not the same. And I just don't think it's right for a person who had the nonviolent versus the violent saying they both have served their time and that it should be the same. It's not the same. And I'm saying to you this, that I have had so many young folks come to me and saying is that when I go to court and I could not afford a lawyer, they put up a court-appointed lawyer. And the court-appointed lawyer would tell them, and I'm talking about my folks now, don't get me wrong, said to them, well, just plead guilty, you can tell the kid home. And that record stays right there. Okay? He can go home, just plead guilty. Another court-appointed lawyer, because he can't make no money. Let him go home. Then 20 years later, that same kid who pleaded guilty because some lawyer told him 20 years ago, now he wants to get a job and all. What happened? Boom, he came. That's not right. So I'm thinking about now. At least rights were restored. Who could say that we would have another term for color coming up? We would never have another governor like this governor. 227,000 in 1 year. It won't happen. At least a Republican had good sense, bless his heart. At least he is saying to me that, hey, nonviolent who paid the fines, time, what have you, that it's done. And I'm saying to y'all, don't make a mistake about it. Nonviolent and violent the same way. You can't treat them the same. And I'm asking this committee, please support this bill. Because I'm concerned, unless they're better way, and now that violent with the substitute, they do have some rights as before going before the government. They can do that. So I'm saying to this, it's not a Democrat Republican bill. This is the veteran's right. And I'm looking out for my folks as well as everybody else. And I ask my staff to pull it up, let me know the violent crime versus the nonviolent crime. Over the bill, nonviolent crime. Where do you go to jail for? Smoking pot. Stuff like that. And then they gotta wait until some governor decides on that I'm gonna restore your rights. Same as the person who committed a crime that killed somebody. I'm concerned that we need to take this away, that particular bill, out of the governor. I'm concerned that we want to make sure that those who committed nonviolent crime, once you do your time and you pay your fine, what have you, they would not have to depend on any government. But those who kill somebody, rob, hurt, and rape somebody, yes, you go for the government, let him make that thing for you. Yeah. And this is right. But I know, I have questioned it. I'm 7 years old, and I have questioned a long time ago that how come on nonviolent crime that black folks treat different white folks? And I'm 7 years old. It ain't right. So I'm saying this right now. Nonviolent crime, I thank Senator Sonoma. I thank him and Mr. Madam Chairman. I want to make a motion for it because this is the right thing to do. Praise the Lord. Thank you.
And Senator Chase, thank you. But in the meantime, Senator Howell has a comment. No, but I will say this subcommittee report has gotten way more interesting and juicy. And the report was going to kill everybody with boredom. Okay, Senator Howell.
I actually had a question to make sure I understood. The only difference between Senator Roman's bill and the substitute is the addition of names. The text is the same.
And I made the mistake. I just have to interrupt by saying that Meg, who usually sits here, is out with the flu. And we have David Cotter here, who is sitting in as Meg. So, David, please.
A poor substitute for Meg.
David, please proceed.
Madam Chair, Based on the motion that Senator Costa has made, what would be reporting out is exactly as Senator Powell described it. It would be the text of the engineer's version of Senator Norman's Senate Joint Resolution 223. If you incorporate the names, with the names added.
Madam Chair.
Senator Deeds.
And Mr. Cotter might be the right person to ask this question. I'm looking at this, as I understand it, under this language, with respect to violent criminals, they would just not have, they'd be out of luck. The governor wouldn't have the ability to restore their rights. And I'm trying to figure out what are defined as violent crimes of the General Assembly right now.
Madam Chair, answering his first question, as the introduced text, he is correct that violent felonies, which would then be defined by the General Assembly, would not get their rights restored. We have two definitions that we use in the code frequently for violent felonies. There's acts of violence in 19.2-297.1, which is the three strikes laws, where you first strike one of those offenses, get you life in prison. The other one is 17.1-805, which is violent felony offense, which is used for purposes of sentencing guidelines. So usually when we're dealing with those kind of terms in the code, we either pick one or both of those definitions, depending on what group we're trying to cover.
Madam Chair, what I'm trying to figure
Senator
out,
Deeds.
There's some crimes defined as violent in the code that don't actually require a crime of violence. They might involve a drug deal, but they don't involve actually hurting somebody physically.
Yes, sir.
Exactly.
Mr. Chairman, there may be crimes that people on the list of violent, either one of those two lists that people would not define as violent, though drug crimes are not included in violent lists.
Madam Chair.
Senator Gantz.
Having had my SJ 253 defeated, my bill would have allowed us to automatically restore the rights of nonviolent felons, and it would have allowed the governor to retain the right to address violent felons. This one does not. This one removes that authority. That's the difference between mine and this one. The reason I asked to have mine not rolled in so that I can get a vote on it. And it failed, but that was the intent of it. Thank you.
Madam Chairman.
Senator Howell.
Having now realized I made a mistake in how I voted on Senator Dance's bill, I want to apologize to her, because I think what she's saying is exactly how I feel about this. I don't want to take away the discretion of the governors to restore rights of those who have been convicted of violent crimes, but who have indeed changed and rehabilitated themselves. This bill in front of us, although it is fine for nonviolent criminals, really puts us out of step with how the rest of the country is moving vis-a-vis violent criminals, people convicted of violent crimes. More and more states are automatically restoring rights, and that's where I'd like us to be. So I'm finding myself in a situation where I'm going to vote against this bill, believing that we can do better in the future, and right now, leaving the discretion with the governor will indeed result in more people getting their rights restored.
Bravo.
Madam Chair.
Senator Cosgrove.
It's nice to be here. I'm from Virginia, but I'm going to report this. I would say you might want to get one something on the floor, and if you want to force us to get a form, and that's the way it goes. So I renew my motion to bill report.
Okay. All right, so the first motion, actually, Senator Cosgrove, would be for you to make the motion that we roll SJRs 222, 243, 272, and 319 into SJR 223.
Yes,
and I will entertain that motion, and Senator Chase seconds. All in favor of incorporating those resolutions, please vote on your screen aye and nay, same sign.
Should vote against again.
So it's 9 yeas and 5 nays, and so now those resolutions are rolled together. So,
Madam Chair, now to remove that, reading my motion to report Senate Joint Resolution 223.
Okay, so Senator Crossgrove moves and Senator Chase seconds that we report SJR 223. All in favor, please vote report as a substitute. SJ 223, all in favor, please vote on your screen. Aye or nay, same sign. And the bill reports 8 ayes, 6 nays. Senator Cosgrove.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I have just one more issue, and that's dealing with redistricting. We have 5 more bills dealing with redistricting as well. We have Senator Sturdivant's Senator Resolution 230, Senator Barker's 260, Senator Deeds 269, Senator Lewis, 280, and Senator Hanger, 231. The recommendation of the subcommittee was to roll 230, 260, 269, and 280 into Senator Hanger's SJ 231. I voted for the two last time.
Okay. The motion has been made that they all be rolled together in Senator Hanger's SJ 231. It's been properly seconded. All in favor? We're going to wait for the clerk. Get ready. The clerk is ready. We're going to vote on our screen. How is my Senate page? You need to hide embarrassment because I asked Senator Lewis, Lucas, and Senator Suderline, we're going to hurry, I promise. Okay, so the motion passes, and they are now incorporated, and then Senator Crossgrove, your motion is to...
My motion is to report SJ 231 as a substitute.
Okay, so the motion is the substitute be reported. Senator Ruff seconds. All in favor of reporting the substitute, which is Senator Hanger's bill on redistricting, please vote aye. Oh, okay. Okay, the vote is open. Please vote aye and nay, same sign. And the redistricting commission criteria, redistricting reform reports 12 to 2. Okay, Senator Crossgrove. That completes your subcommittee report. Thank you very much. You did an extraordinary amount of work in your subcommittee, and we really appreciate it. And we regret that we had 3 P&E committee meetings, and all that work had to be done in the subcommittee, and we appreciate everybody's patience. We have a sign-up sheet. First on the sign-up sheet is Senator, but he's across the hall, so he's not here. So, Senator Lucas, you are next. Thank you for your patience. And I would like for everybody to direct their attention to Senate Bill 846. Senator Lucas.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. I have been patient. I've been waiting 25 years for this bill.
That's a long time, Senator Lucas.
Yes, ma'am. Chair and members of the committee, this is the Virginia Interim Redistricting Commission bill. This committee has seen this bill before. It's almost like a flower. It grows every year that I'm back in the session. This is the same bill as Senate Bill 31, which passed out of this committee last year, 12-1, and passed the full Senate 32-7. It was laid on the table in the House of Delegates. This bill would establish a Virginia Interim Redistricting Commission to draft a remedial plan if a court holds a redistricting plan unconstitutional and orders districts to be redrawn. Under this bill, an independent commission would provide the General Assembly with a recommended plan. The General Assembly will still have to approve a plan in a special session. However, the interim commission would hold the public hearings, prepare a remedial plan using objectives, clearly defined redistricting criteria, and give the General Assembly a well-drawn, finished product to work with. This, Madam Chair and members of the committee, is a good bill for several reasons. It includes the same commission membership, structure, and redistricting criteria like the independent commission bill that was offered by Senator Vogel and me that passed the Senate in 2015, and the bill offered this year by Senator Sturdivant and Senator Hainer. It also addresses a real problem. In 2015, the congressional redistricting case, the federal court ordered to redraw the third congressional district, but the General Assembly was not able to get the job done. As a result, the taxpayers had to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to pay the lawyers and a court-appointed special master to draw the new congressional plan. With this bill, we can streamline the process and give the General Assembly a good starting product if a court-ordered redrawn district becomes necessary. Madam Chair, there's a lot more that I can say that I did say last year, dating back to 1991 when I was first elected to the Senate of Virginia, and we've gone to court three different times under three different lawsuits trying to get these districts so that they were more compact. But I would like for you to give me an opportunity to have Greg Lucy to come forward and speak on behalf of the bill as well. Who?
Come on up. Welcome.
My lawyer of 26
years. I know your lawyer. I'm glad you had them. Welcome. We don't know anything about this subject. Go ahead.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Senator Lucas has said it all. This bill is virtually identical in terms of commission structure and the criteria to SJ 231 that you just reported out, Senator Hanger's bill. The only difference is it's an advisory commission, and it is set up quickly if there's a court order requiring a redraw to give the body a good, well-defined plan that it can consider for purposes of remedial action for the court's order. And it'll save the Commonwealth money because we won't need the special master and the lawyers arguing in court over which part of the plan is good or bad or what. So Senator Lucas has explained the bill well. It's supported by One Virginia 2021, and we hope the committee will pass the bill.
Okay. Thank you, Senator Lucas. Considering that this committee has favorably acted on other bills that were very similar, I'm going to consider that we probably don't need a lot of other discussion. Is there anybody else who has a question of the patron or anybody else who wishes to speak on this bill? Okay, committee operates on a motion. Okay, the motion has been made and properly seconded to report Senate Bill 846. All in favor, please vote aye. Nay, same sign. Okay, the bill reports 12-2.
Thank you, Madam
Congratulations.
Chair. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it because both Greg and myself have grown great at this podium trying to get this bill passed.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
Senator McPike. Welcome. Everybody, please direct your attention to Senate Bill 1543.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And members of the committee, Senate Bill 1543 seeks to provide a framework to require candidates for president to require them to release 5 years of their tax returns prior to be listing on the state either primary or general election ballot. So this is something that I think is important. We've had a long history, over 40 years, of those candidates who wish to seek votes in Virginia have provided that in the past. I don't view this as a partisan issue, despite maybe a couple grumblings. To the point that if you wanted to add birth certificates to this as an amendment, you're welcome to add those in lines 37, 80, and 84. To improve the posture. And the good news is this is no fiscal impact to this bill, Madam Chair.
So you're saying it doesn't have to go to finance?
That is firm.
Okay, is there any member of the committee who has a question for the patron? Is there anybody in the audience who wishes to speak in support of the bill? Is there anybody who wishes to speak in opposition to the bill?
Report.
Okay, the motion has been made and properly seconded to report Senate Bill 1543. All in favor, please vote. Senator Spruill.
I have a question for some sort of loop, dance, but I must be doing something wrong.
Just hit it again.
Hit it one more time. Okay, so the bill fails to report 6 ayes, 8 nays. Thank you, Senator McKay. Okay. Okay, next on the list is Senator Lewis. Senator Lewis. A whole bunch of bills.
Yes, ma'am.
You can decide which one you want to do first.
Okay, I'll start at the top of the stack. That would be Senate Bill 1206, Madam Chair.
Okay, everybody direct your attention to Senate Bill 1206.
And this is an idea that certainly this committee has seen before, so I know you all are well familiar with it, so I won't belabor it too much. This is the, essentially, this is the Iowa redistricting model to establish a redistricting, nonpartisan redistricting commission. And again, I know this committee has seen this many times before, and actually, I believe has acted favorably on it in some instances in the past. Specifically, it prohibits the consideration of certain raw political data in the establishment of these districts. Incumbent legislators and members of Congress, political affiliations of registered voters, previous election results, and anything demographic in nature that is not required by the United States Constitution, the law of the United States. Establish a redistricting advisory commission, Madam Chair, 5 members, one from each caucus of each legislative body, and then they elect a 5th member as a chairman. That their primary goal or primary thing that they do is to advise the legislative services in drawing up these maps. There are 3 attempts made at presenting the map. Each time it's presented to the legislature and fails to reach the constitutional threshold, it can be returned with comments to the Division of Legislative Services for them to redraw the map. On the 3rd time, the bill is capable of being amended. The first 3 times, it is not capable of being amended by the legislature. On the 3rd time, if they fail to adopt it, it is capable of being amended. They also have to return it, obviously, each time on the previous 2 attempts with the reasons that the legislature, that they are rejecting the map. So that's it in a nutshell, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Again, this works in Iowa. They have very competitive districts there, and many members of this committee on both sides of the aisle have recognized this problem and are attempting to deal with it. It is a problem. I think it's a very fundamental problem. My team has been drawing lines every bit as ideologically compact as they had in the software, but I think it's time that we really need to stop this partisan positioning, because we can really, I think it's impeding our ability to deal with some of the big questions it faces.
Any member of the committee or the question of the patron? Senator Dance.
Yeah. Senator Lewis, are you familiar with Senator Lucas's bill? Can you tell me how your bill might in some way be similar or not similar to her?
It may be, Senator Dance. Frankly, I'm not familiar with hers, so I can't really comment.
Madam Chair,
Senator Deeds.
If you're talking about the bill that you just took up with Senator Lucas, that bill is primarily aimed at situations where have a redistricting commission on hand in case courts set aside a district. So this aims at a longer term view. I mean, I've incorporated part of this bill, I think, in constitutional amendment I've introduced multiple times over the years. I think part about the standards, the 21-301.5, 9113 on down. That part's been the constitutional amendment that I've introduced in a number of times. This primarily is aimed at setting up a redistricting commission that forgets about where we live, forgets about the political performance of areas, doesn't look at anything but population and impact in contiguous districts.
That's correct. And Madam Chair and Senator Dance, this is, again, as I said, this is shamefully stealing from the state of Iowa, where this process has worked pretty well.
clarify, this is similar to the constitutional amendment that we addressed in terms of substance, which is similar to the bill that we reported. Is there anybody who has anything new to add that has not already been heard, who's here in the audience who wants to speak? Because obviously we heard from the redistricting proponents and subcommittee in here just a minute ago. Okay, the committee operates on a motion.
Move report.
Okay, Senator Deek moves and Senator Dance seconds that the that SB 1206 be reported. All in favor, please vote aye. Okay, bill fails to report, 7-7. Okay.
What's the motion number?
It's
7-7.
Okay, you have SJ 331.
Yes, ma'am. My understanding that was going to be rolled into...
SJ 280 was rolled in, but SJ 331...
Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry, I apologize. Yeah. Yes, and that is very straightforward, very simple. You'll see the guts of the bill on line 75 through 78. What we're attempting to do here is give localities another tool in the toolbox should they choose to avail themselves of it. To encourage local landowners to provide amelioration and act proactively in regard to flooding on their property. So it provides the localities with the authority to provide a partial exemption for local real estate property taxes for folks who choose to improve their real estate, on improved real estate, who choose to take action to mitigate flooding. That's it.
Okay. Is there anybody who has a question of the patron?
Madam Chair, I would add, this is a recommendation from our recurrent flooding study committee chaired by Senator Locke and Delegate Sala.
Okay. Is there anybody in the audience who wishes to speak in favor of the bill? Is there anybody who wishes to speak in opposition to the bill? Okay. Committee operates on a motion.
Move to pull.
Okay. The bill has been moved and properly seconded. All in favor of supporting SJR 331, please vote aye or nay, same sign. Okay, the constitutional amendment reports.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Mason. Okay, Senator Suderline, you are next on the sign-up list.
Please, may I be happy to refer to Senator Newman, who needs to chair
subcommittee. Oh, sorry, Senator Newman, who needs to chair subcommittee. You need to leapfrog. You have Senate Bill 1552.
Madam Chairman, if I could entertain a quick amendment, which is to take out the italicized language on line 55.
Okay, so there was a line amendment on line 55 to remove the italicized language. The line amendment has been moved and properly seconded. All in favor, please say aye. Okay, so the amended line amendment is properly, the bill as amended is properly before us.
Madam Chairman, with that, I think the bill is, I don't know of any opposition to the bill. The bill basically says that when a general registrar is looking to print the number of ballots, that they shall determine the number of ballots based on the historical data of who's voted in the past, also past voter turnout, to come up with the right number. We had a case in Virginia where we ran out of ballots at 9:30, and we're hoping to get more information to be able to make those determinations. That's
okay. Is there anybody has a question from the patron? Anybody in the audience who wishes to speak in opposition? Anybody who wishes to speak in favor of the bill? Okay, the motion has been made and properly seconded to report Senate Bill 1552. All in favor, please vote aye. Nay, same sign. The bill reports unanimously. Thank you, Senator Newman. Okay, Senator Suderline.
I have two bills. Is there any preference?
Nope, you can take them up in any order you choose.
Let's do Senate Bill 1410 first.
Okay.
It also follows for the district theme that we had going. What this does is this adds a compactness standard to the code. This is something that both Senate Privileges and Elections and the full Senate reported out last year. Unfortunately, the other chamber doesn't like anything regarding redistricting at this point in time and did not report favorably on it. So what it would do is it would add a compactness standard to legislative districts in the Commonwealth. Under our most recent districts that we all have, if you look at my district, it has 8 localities in it. Of those 8 counties in the city, or 7 counties in West Sea of Salem, only 2 of them do I have 100% of. These other counties, which aren't very populated, are divided. Often the county seat in them, which are sometimes towns of less than 10,000 people, are also divided right down the middle as well. So I've got, you know, I always love telling folks, I represent the east part of Hillsville, or the west part of Hillsville, the east part of Withville. No good way to describe what I have in Rocky Mount, because I've got 3 corners of it, but not the middle and not most of it. Senator Barker's no longer here, but I thank you for that wonderful opportunity to give these explanations. But what this does is it would actually put a compactness standard. Right now, we already claim to have a compactness method, but we actually don't have any standard that we can do with it. If enacted into law, this would be just like our mathematical standard that we require on a deviation of population, where it'd be up to, we can't bind the future General Assemblies and what they're going to do on this, but they have to say, we've chosen this mathematical standard, and this is how much deviation we've allowed.
Madam Chair.
Senator Deans.
I've got one question. If we adopt this as a statute, would we somehow raise compactness above the
contiguous?
This would add it to the list. We've got several others in there. It would simply say we're actually going to have a standard, because there are folks that will claim what our current districts are compact, even when you have relatively small communities being divided again and again. I tell folks, if you go to Bent Mountain in my district, you actually can go any which way and actually stay in my district for a while. Other than that, you're almost always, you know, about 15-minute drive from getting outside of my district. And it's a large district. It's because it has that many places where it gets that thin. Only in the sparsely populated area near Bent Mountain can you actually drive a little way to stay in my district.
Madam Chair.
Senator Sproul.
And if you do that, then how would you explain the House of Delegates? In the House of Delegates, you've got 6 delegates. You've got Heather Knight, Bill Williams from June Beach. You've got Chris Jones from Suffolk, with Mark Forsmith. You've got Cliff Hayes and Justin. So if you do what you were saying, so what posture would that put them in? That 6 members of the House, rather than part of the Chesapeake, they live all over the place.
Well, I'm not sure exactly what the senator's asking. I'm not sure I follow that. But what I would say is, what this is doing is simply saying, hey, if adopted, we're going to say, here's the mathematical standard, how much deviation we allow in the compactness. Just as we actually require, currently, a population deviation standard. Back in 2011, when the lines were drawn, it was decided that 2% would be the standard deviation for the Senate. And so what that meant was you couldn't have a district that had more than 204,000 people. You couldn't have one with less than 196,000 under the Senate system. This would say we'll come up with the number, and we'll look at it based on the realities of what the time dictates it be, and then we'll go from there. I mean, right now we have so many districts which we claim are compact, but we actually don't have a standard that even we acknowledge.
Thank you.
Just to clarify for any member of the committee who have a question, the language that we're talking about in terms of compactness, is it virtually identical word for word to what this committee...
What you already passed out
in Hangers, SJ. But to be clear to Senator Deeds' question, what you're doing is you're pulling that out and you're isolating this specifically. And I think to speak to what the senator's proposal is, I think he thinks that perhaps this might be the least controversial things we might move through that has a meaningful impact on redistricting.
Yeah, I would say
that has a way, has a means of passing, and I don't mean to put words in his mouth, but I know that it is something that he believes, you know, might have some success. But then Senator Deeds' question was, well, are we elevating this over something else? But then we also have the courts to look to, which say compact, contiguous communities of common interest and have set a standard for redistricting. It also includes what the Department of Justice has included. So
I guess, Madam Chair, that would be my issue, that by passing this without also something deals with contiguous districts or communities of interest, we're somehow elevating this compactness above the other considerations.
Madam Chair, I would just say
Senator Sugarline.
We've already passed those other things. I don't know how you would say we're going to measure communities of interest this way. There are actual ways to measure population deviation. That's why we require. There are actual ways to measure compactness and how far they go. And it hasn't been asked, but I'll just mention because it got asked last year. The Voting Rights Act is federal law, supersedes anything we do anyways. So even if it's necessary to draw districts to comply with the Federal Voting Rights Act, which I certainly don't want to, that's not what this legislation is about, that would still supersede it, and then we'd go from the compactness of population there. It's just as the population standard we currently have doesn't supersede the Voting Rights Act either.
Okay. We've had a lot of debate on redistricting. I know we need to go back and revisit this again after it's been fully heard in subcommittee, but this was different than the bills that were rolled together. So the committee operates on a motion. Is there a motion? Senator Reeves moves, and Senator Chase seconds that we report SB 1410. All in favor, please vote aye. Okay, 6 ayes, 8 nays, and the bill fails to report. Thank you, Senator Sugarline. You have Senate Bill 1585.
Yes. The other one, Senate Bill 1585, is something that was passed last year by both the Senate and the House. The governor did not see the wisdom of it. What it does is it says that for all the offices that are already partisan offices in the Commonwealth, where you can seek a nomination by running in the Republican primary or Democratic primary, which taxpayers have to pay for. So already it's a partisan office, already taxpayers have paid, the policy of the Commonwealth paid for, we're actually going to let folks know that that who is nominated by which party. We'll put an R or a D on the ballot. It's in the same way we have it, and in the same way that has it. And I'm sure I'll probably get to address you again in a minute. So unless you have a question for me about what it actually does.
Okay, is there any member of the committee with a question? I see there is a member of the audience who wishes to speak in favor of the bill and in opposition to the bill.
Madam Chairman, members of the committee, I'm Mary Jo Fields with the Virginia Municipal League, and we testified against this bill last year and continue to ask you to consider retaining the nonpartisanship of local elections. Right now, most municipalities in the state, particularly towns, their charters just reference the general law in setting out how people get on the ballot. The practice has been, in most towns in particular, and in a number of the cities, that the elections are nonpartisan. We think that operates well at the local level. We think running a government is, there's not, what local governments do is nonpartisan in terms of having to raise the funds to pay for services that the state might require us and that our own citizens might require. There's not a Republican or a Democratic way of fighting a fire or enforcing the building code or doing any of the number of services that local governments have. We think that the availability of a party identification on the ballot will in fact increase partisanship because more people it'll be an easier way to get on the ballot, to get elected, and more people will pursue that. Our executive committee met last week and adopted a resolution in opposition to the bill asking you to please consider leaving things as they are
And I have a copy of that if I could give it to y'all. And then our president is here to speak as well.
Okay, thank you very much.
Madam Chair.
Senator Chase?
I would just like to make a comment, if I could, in speaking in favor of the bill. And having run a number of campaigns in my career, and I would tell you that as a form of transparency, it is important to individuals and voters who may not be as informed as the political stripes of those running, even at the local level, to know what the political stripes are of those who are running, even in local government. There are different philosophies out there, and so you know, there's certainly the option to run as an independent, as an option, but I would support transparency, and if a candidate wants to run under a particular party, then I think they should have the ability to do that.
Good afternoon, welcome.
Good afternoon, Madam Chairman and members of the committee. I'm Bob Coyner, Mayor of Gordonsville and President of Virginia Municipal League. On behalf of Virginia Cities and Towns, I urge you to oppose Senate Bill 1585 and keep our local elections nonpartisan. I can tell you that if it's one issue in 17 years that people are united for, it's this. It's not just the local politicians, it's all the people that are in it. People are proud of that. You know, they're going through all the angst nationally now, politically. And that's fine. I do think that, you know, with the political differences and philosophies, parties are needed at the state and the national level. So it's necessary. But everybody says, you know, local government is the oasis of unity. You know, we come together. Now, and I point of full disclosure, that's not in my notes, but I'll just say that statewide, it's a name, and you need a disclosure. Locally, you know the people personally. There's always full disclosure. Everyone knows exactly how you are. You tend to be more conservative, more liberal. But I can also tell you something, that if I've got four far-left people on my committee, on my council, or seven far-right, you'll never be able to know the difference. It's obvious here. It's not local. We don't have the flexibility in our revenue. It's set here at the General Assembly. If you put in a new income tax that was broad range instantly, I might agree with it, because it would matter then, are you Republican or Democrat? Believe high taxes, low taxes. We've got property taxes. Anyone it raises, it puts it on the lowest among, you know, the least able to afford it. So it's self-constraining. I see no issues. We don't take up big social costs. Now, some cities like to see their name in the paper. They take them up. We don't take on the United Nations and most small towns in Gordonsville. The people always know. And if they don't, I think they do. But if they don't, what they do around the state is they have the ballot out front going in. They get it, and they see who's Republican, who's a Democrat. There is never an issue of not knowing that. But given that, when they go in, they're elected, it doesn't matter. You vote for the sidewalk to be redone, the sidewalk that needs it the most, with the same funds. So, you know, it's just not an issue. I can tell you that communities universally, I've talked to people around the country in the last 2 years, in the last 20 years, I've talked around the state, thousands of people. I'm sure someone agreed with it, somewhere along the way. The count must be 4,001, if it is. They like one place in this world where it's nonpartisan. And if you don't respect the thousands of the local officials that feel that way strongly, think about those that preceded you. These issues have come up for a million years in the General Assembly, and they've always supported keeping it nonpartisan. Please don't break something that's not broken. Thank you very much.
Madam Chair.
May I respond to some of that?
Let me let Senator Chase speak, and then you can respond to all of it. Great.
I would like to speak to
Mr. Okay, Mr. Senator Chase, and then Senator Dance.
With all due respect to the gentleman that just spoke, I've actually run a number of local government races as well. And in a county as large as Chesterfield, we don't necessarily know each other as much as we'd like to try. And so I would tell you that it's very helpful to know a leading other person, because you know, if it's just important to some people to know that. And I think it's in the best interest of transparency at the local level, and I think that the constituents want to know. So I speak in support of the bill and just wanted to clarify that this is also at the local level for individuals in my district would like transparency.
Senator Deans.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Having served in local government and having served as a mayor of a city, I will tell you that I served 12 years, but during that 12 years, I had three vice mayors. The female, she was independent. She voted one way or the other. And I knew this because we had a good relationship. One of the males that served with me was a Democrat, and the other one was Republican. And I will tell you that the community embraced them all, did not ask, did not know, probably, who was a Democrat and who was a Republican, because it was those local issues, and we worked well together. Best time, still my friend, all three of them. And I will tell you, at that level, it really is about the issues. That when we get bogged down in trying to figure out that we have a good Democrat or a good Republican to play at that local level, when sometimes the talent pool is not that great, that this person might be the ideal person and we need that person, but we don't elect that person because he's not of the same ilk or the same this or that, then the community leaves out, loses out. The best times was when we voted, and I'll tell you that people might say, and I don't see where it wasn't transparent. The transparency in that level was that were they good or were they not? They show it was what they did, the actions of the people. And they were all concerned about the community, and that was important. But you're right, when you leave that level, I found that out too. Then you have to put on a uniform if you want to represent your locality. You wear your uniform, you run your race, but then ultimately you're going to still govern. So I don't understand the need for such a bill.
Senator Deeds?
Yeah. I've been here for a little while, and I represent now six counties, four cities, and six towns. And some of those localities, they elect their local governing bodies through partisan nominations. Most don't, but some do, and some are pretty partisan. And, you know, as I see this bill, I think it's for low-information voters. Most of those communities, they know dang on well what the politics are of the people they're elected, whether they are nominated by the party or not. I see, you know, partisanship to some extent has risen in the years I've been involved in this process, and I don't think that's for the better. I think that especially at local government, people need to be focused on moving the community forward, on getting things done locally, and I see this as something that can drive a wedge in local governing bodies. And that's why it would worry me to have to encourage further division. I see some of the localities that I do represent where there is partisanship, and there's more division than is necessary. And so I won't vote for this.
Senator Suderlein, you had asked if you could respond, and I'm for it.
Everyone speaking, you want to now just close. And
okay, Senator Evan.
Just to speak briefly in favor of the bill, I understand that there's some folks who like to have nonpartisanship, and I would say a lot of localities have partisan elections, and if we're going to allow the political parties to nominate someone, why would we then keep that information from the voters as to where they came from? And there is a time for nonpartisanship, and I would say that's after the election when we're working together. It's just like running for this body, except this body, we do have more pronounced divisions between political parties. But after we're elected, it's our job to work together regardless of a party. But before the elections, we're certainly going to let our voters know if we affiliate with them. And I would just say, if we don't want partisanship, we should have nonpartisan local elections, which is, you know, another choice. I'm going to vote for the bill.
Madam Chair.
Senator Sproul.
To my friend, something else. I understand, because he's from North Virginia. 95% of North Virginia goes Democratic anyway. So I need for that. I mean, when we have our election, general election, and we say, who gonna win governorship? Everything is ends up in Norfolk, Virginia. You know who gonna win. So I see why you for it, because everybody in Norfolk is Democrats anyway. So no, how am I supposed to call Norfolk, Virginia? I live in Chesapeake, I live in Norfolk, Virginia.
So on that note, Senator Suterline, how would you like to respond to any or all of the above?
Yeah, I guess I'll start in reverse order. I would point out to the senator from Chesapeake that I can't remember which one's north and which one's south, Senator Spruill.
I'm sorry.
But
North Virginia's the other Virginia.
So I would suggest that if you only had the good opportunity to visit with Senator Evan in Northern Virginia and see how Democratic that is, you should ask Senator Deeds to lunch sometime in Charlottesville and just find out how many Republicans are there. As that is definitely one of the localities that does have big-time Democratic primaries, blowout primaries that taxpayers get to pay for, but that it doesn't appear on the ballot. There have been, in 2015, the last time local elections were on the ballot, there were primaries in Hanover, Henrico, Prince Edward, Stafford, Arlington, Charlottesville, Alexandria, Fauquier, Cosin, Stafford, York, Bedford, Fairfax, Franklin, Prince Edward, all across the Commonwealth. Republican, Democratic, taxpayers got to pay for them all. And then when they go to the ballot box in November, it's not there. And just as Senator Evans said, if you want to have a nonpartisan election, you can do that. You'll notice something that was missing from that list of localities I just read. There wasn't a single town on there. You just heard from Mayor Fordingsville, which for those of you that aren't as familiar with it, he said everyone there knows, you know, everyone's politics. That's a town, according to the census, of 1,496 people. I'd suggest in the town, probably have a pretty good idea of what people's politics are there. But that's a town. That's not affected by this bill at all. If someone wanted to run as a Republican nominee in that town against him or as a Democratic nominee, that's impossible. You cannot have a Republican nomination or Democratic nomination for the town election there. My bill would not affect them. What this goes after is cities and counties where we already have partisan elections. The cities that have chosen to have nonpartisan elections, like Virginia Beach and Falls Church and several others, they have already made that distinction, Chesapeake. So you won't have to worry about it there because you've already made the policy distinction that it's a nonpartisan election. Folks in places that have Charlottesville that are making the taxpayers pay for these, you know, we're actually going to let the people know what the results of that were and who's a Democrat and who's a Republican out there. And I would just point out, this is not about elections in towns of less than 2,000 people. I'm not trying to affect what happens there. This is in actual cities and counties where people are nominated by the Republican and Democratic parties through state-run, taxpayer-paid-for primaries. That's all it does. And when it was pointed out that for a million years, Virginia didn't do this, I would point out that there was an organization called the Byrd Organization that wasn't really interested in people knowing exactly what was on the ballot for a good portion of that. And it wasn't quite a million, but it was 400 almost. So unless there's any more questions, that's all I've got to say.
Madam Chairman, I'm going to report. Okay. Senator Chase. And is there a second?
Second.
And Senator Evans seconds that we report Senate Bill 1585. All in favor, please vote aye.
Aye.
The bill reports 9 ayes and 5 nays. Thank you, Senator Suterline. Okay. Senator Mason.
I'm Chair.
Welcome.
Thank you, ma'am.
You've got Senate Bill 1133. Everybody, please direct your attention to Senate Bill 1133.
From partisan conversation to the most nonpartisan issues, madam. This is one that you've seen many times. In fact, it's another example of a place that Senator John Miller and I have worked together on for the last several years. Senator Miller Kerry brought this bill to this body, and it passed out of the Senate 39-0 a couple years ago. I would say that although this is not a new concept for the committee, the timing is ideal. On the ballot on 17, as and you'll note online, and the question would be on lines 17 to 20. But you'll note on line 35 that this referendum is advisory only. So the timing is very good for it to be done in 17. It would take 18 and 19 and through the chamber again in advance of the 20 census and the 21 redistricting. So, Madam Chairman, I'm happy to walk through the bill in detail, but I think it's a concept familiar to us all.
Madam Chair.
Senator Sproul.
Tell me, how can you get an independent district commission?
So,
I'm going to be as this. Everyone has a vote. Let me use Chesapeake for example. If you pick someone from Great Bridge, I'm already saying, that's Republican. You pick someone from South Norfolk, I'm already saying, that's Democrat. So I'm trying to figure out if a person can really pick a commissioner that would really not in the back of their mind would not a D or R to be fair.
Sure. Madam Chair, Senator Sproul, that is a question for another day, and a very good one. The one thing that's changed about this topic is more people are talking about it. And so this would only ask the voters to decide, do they believe that an independent redistricting commission should be established? And so, to your point, sir, that will be the next step challenge. But this is just asking the voters, is this a path we should go down?
Okay. This is very similar to Senate Bill 846, which was Senator Lucas's bill that we previously heard. Very, very, very similar. Is there anybody here who has any questions of a substantive nature?
Report.
Okay. Motion has been made, properly seconded, to report Senate Bill 846. It does have a... I'm sorry. Senate Bill 1133. I'm stuck on Senator Lucas's bill. And it does have a fiscal impact, and so the proper motion is actually going to be report.
Yes, thank you. And report to finance?
Report and report to finance.
Thank you.
Okay. So the motion has been made and properly seconded to report and refer Senate Bill 1133 to finance. All in favor, please vote aye. Nay, same sign.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It's been smooth sailing up there to this point.
Thank you, Senator Mason. All right, there you go. Okay. So that completes everybody who is on the sign-up sheet. And so now we are going to committee members.
I've got an easy bill.
Okay, Senator Heath, go ahead.
1059. This is a bill that I thought of and just thought I'd introduce it after I went to the NCSL program out in Chicago. This is the same day voter registration, something Utah had luck with. They and I thought, why not try a pilot project in Virginia to see if we could get people registered to vote? And it's as simple as that. So the bill would allow the Department of Elections to institute a pilot project sometime between now and 2019. The idea is that they would institute this in one or more locality and to see if same-day registration would work.
Okay, is there any member of the committee who has a question? Senator Yeats? Is there any member of the audience who wishes to speak in opposition to the bill? Okay, please come forward.
I'm from the ACLU of Virginia, and just a couple of concerns. Our opposition is really based on the fact that we would like to see this apply statewide for everybody, not to require a pilot program per se, but to honor Virginia's Constitution, to have uniformity in the registration process and program, and extend this courtesy to everyone statewide. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon. Welcome.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Members of the committee, Clara Wheeler, Vice Chair of the State Board of Elections. For those of you who have worked in a registrar's office and who have worked on election day of the campaign, there's a lot going on. To further compound what has to be done on election day with trying to figure out whether somebody should be registered to vote or not, will, I can tell you, lead to total chaos. The registrar has to check the registration application, has to go into the VERIS system, has to check this person's, if you will, credentials and application to make sure that they are a valid or entitled to be a valid voter in Virginia. Trying to do this on election day is going to be a very, very difficult, if not impossible, task for the registrars and the registrars' offices. And you will end up with people maybe being registered to vote who should not be registered to vote because maybe they live in a different community. Or somebody who doesn't get registered who is entitled. There's no emergency in registering to vote. You have plenty of time to do it before election day. I would ask you please respectfully send needs to think better of this option.
Oh, Madam Chair, this is the bill that I got from Utah that worked well. It's worked there well for several years, and so I thought we could just try it here. And that's why the way it's written, the Board of Elections decides where they're going to try. I mean, I respect the lady that testified before said we ought to do it statewide. Well, I wasn't ready to do that. I wanted to make sure it would work before if we try anything more. But
thank you.
Madam
Chair. Thank you,
Senator Evan.
Yeah. I just want to ask, is it Ms. Wheeler?
Yes, sir.
I want to ask Ms. Wheeler, this seems to work in Utah, Minnesota, Wisconsin, other states, and you said it would lead to chaos in Virginia. I just want to know how come they can do it less chaotically than we can.
I'm not an expert on voting in Utah, Minnesota, or anywhere else where they use same-day voting, or same-day registration voting. But I know that every time this has been discussed in this body, there's been a lot of opposition to it because it's very difficult to manage the normal process of voting on election day and then have the registrar's offices be charged with, if you will, investigating, which is what applying to register vote is, and then having that name put into the system to make sure that they are who they say they are. I think it's a very difficult prospect, and I would, again, I'm not an expert from Utah, Minnesota, but I'll be willing to wager that their records are probably not as accurate as they need to be if they register and vote on the same day.
Madam Chair, I'm not even an expert from Bath County. What I point to is on lines 17 through 22, paragraphs A, 2, and 3. This would only apply in counties and cities that applied to the Board of Elections and agreed to participate in their pilot project. So maybe nobody would apply. I don't know.
Senator Evans.
Just briefly to follow up, you said that they have to check that people are who they say they are, and I didn't quite get that part.
Well, when you fill out, as you have done, fill out a voter registration application, there are things on that application that must be verified by going into the central computer system. And all of you had the opportunity to see that the central computer system didn't work real well this summer and fall. And you were in a joint P&E committee because the system wasn't working. And if we further maybe that failure was because we asked the system to do too many things at once. And so I'm afraid that if we ask the system and the people operating the system to do more than they're already doing on election day, you'll end up with mistakes.
Thank you.
Senator Sproul.
In Utah, there's nobody in Utah. There's in Utah. I'm trying to figure out in Chesapeake and Norfolk, election day, the lines are so backed up. We have made national news. When President Obama ran the last time, the national news, all the press in there came down because it's 8 o'clock. They had lines all around the building, all kinds of problems. So I can't support this bill. No way we have a problem already as far as getting
getting people in and out, shame breaking down the problem they're having, and they are working themselves to death. Bless your heart, you're doing that. But compared to Utah, I'm running the campaign. I had to find the folks. Utah.
Madam Chair, so I'd like to make some motion to PBI.
I second.
Senator Chase moves and Senator Poole seconds that we pass by indefinitely Senate Bill 1059. All in favor, please vote aye. Okay, the bill is passed by indefinitely 9-6. Or 9-5. Okay. Senator Doucette.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, we have in front of us Senate Bill 1490, electronic voting for deployed military. This is one that we've seen at least for the last 4 years. It was originally carried by Senator Fuller back 4 years ago. And then we tasked the administration with executing on this, and it never got executed on. I brought this up last year, and it was killed then. So I was going to bring it back up again this year. And what this bill does is very simple. It directs Department of Elections to put in place a system that allows for absentee voting for military members who are deployed overseas. It's that simple. There are many systems out there that are being used today. And that's it. Happy to answer any questions. I know we have folks in opposition and we have folks in support.
Senator,
Senator Reeves.
Senator DeStef, I know Colonel Penny's been working on this as part of the JLC, which is the Joint Leadership Council of all the veterans organizations. I think, yes, data that we didn't have last year and that this is currently being done in other states effectively. I know this is a bill to pilot it. I am carrying the budget amendment for it, but maybe you have Colonel Penny speak to the bill.
Madam Chair, if I may.
Yes,
Senator Reese.
Senator Zepp.
We may want to hear the opposition first because I believe Colonel Penna's information actually will answer a lot of the questions that they're going to pose.
Okay, before we move to the audience, is there any member of the committee that has a question for Senator Zepp?
Yeah.
Okay. Senator Evan.
Briefly, I know that this, I guess it was this summer, maybe it was in 2015, that there were reports of Pentagon computers being hacked by Russians. With you know all the talk about hacking lately, and that what is there something better in this bill that makes it easier or harder to hack than it would have been last year?
Well, with this bill, they use the common access card, the CAP card that military members are issued, and the CAP cards have yet to be hacked. They've never had compromise other than a person handed a CAP card and allowing somebody else to use their thumbprint to access a computer.
Madam Chair, one more question. I had an article, I don't know if it's still accurate, from 2016, that DOD plans to eliminate common access cards. Those are the cards you're talking about?
That's correct. Madam Chair, Senator Evans, that is correct.
Okay, so they're going to ask.
Correct that they're going to eliminate them?
I'm not sure. I'm not aware of them being eliminated. I know that every member of the military has a permanent CAP card, which has their medical record, their service record, and a ton of information on it. So if they're going to eliminate them, I'm sure they're going to phase something else in, at which time we would just adopt whatever the new industry standard is or new military standard is.
Okay, Senator Sproul.
Can Russia get them? Can Russia capture this machine?
I don't believe that the Russians can gather the CAP card and the individual signature to break in to the system.
Thank you.
Okay. Anybody in the audience who wishes to speak in opposition to the bill, please come forward. Good afternoon, welcome.
Good afternoon, Senators. Thank you very much for letting me speak. My name is Susan Greenhall. I represent Verified Voting Organization. We are affiliated with Virginia Verified Voting. Verified Voting is a national nonpartisan organization committed to safeguarding democracy in the digital age. We're founded by computer scientists. We focus only on voting system technology to ensure that our votes are cast and counted correctly. We look specifically at the issue of technology from the point of view of computer scientists. And this is a unique problem because other computer science challenges don't require that you perform an operation anonymously. Voting is unlike banking in that you have to be able to cast your vote and not be traced back to it. So to be able to produce a system that is secure and auditable, but also anonymous, is a very difficult challenge. And what's made the transmission of electronic ballots that Senator Steff's bill proposes very difficult. The federal government has looked at this problem and spent many years trying to solve it, starting before the year 2000. In 2002, the National Defense Authorization Act provided an authorization for the Department of Defense to come up with a program to transmit ballots electronically for the military. They've tried for many years to come up with a solution. In 2004, a project was meant to be deployed. It was canceled by the Department of Defense because of security issues. This led to years and years of research, amassing a great deal of research, costing roughly $100 million. And in 2014, after the results kept coming back that we can't do this securely, the National Defense Authorization Act was amended by Senator McConnell to remove the authorization indefinitely at this point because we can't solve this problem. While there may be organizations that support it from the military, from MOA or JLC, the DOD itself does not recommend the return of ballots electronically. And in a report in 2013, the Department of Defense's agency that handles voting for the military wrote, electronic delivery of blank ballots, while combined with the postal return of the voted ballot, remains the most responsible method for moving forward until such time as applicable federal security guidelines are adopted by the EAC. This is a nonpartisan issue. It is a technical issue. We see organizations on both sides of the aisle or both sides of the political spectrum that recommend against using online voting or online ballot return. The Heritage Foundation published a very strong report opposing online voting for all segments of the population called The Dangers of Internet Voting, authored by Hans von Spakovsky, who is President Bush's appointee to the Federal Election Commission. On the other side, the Brennan Center has also very strongly opposed internet voting. It's probably the one area in voting where these two organizations will agree. Our troops must be able to vote safely and securely, but internet voting is not going to be the best way to protect their vote. In 2016, we saw extensive hacking, as the senators have already mentioned, from the Russians. We have heard that a lot of news reports of the hacking of a particular political party, but lesser known is that the actual election infrastructure was targeted in many cases. In June, the FBI shut down the Arizona Secretary of State's website after it was breached. In July, the Illinois voter registration database was breached, and it was discovered that 200,000 voter records were exfiltrated. In August, the FBI issued flash alert to election officials that foreign attackers are targeting their systems. In September, the FBI director testified to Congress that hackers have tried to infiltrate over 20 states' voter registration data systems, and four states were successfully infiltrated. And also in September, the FBI held a call with Florida County election officials to warn them that hackers had tried to break into Florida's voting system. And in October, it was reported that a Florida voting system vendor that produces e-poll books was also hacked into by Russian attackers, who was attributed to Russian attackers. In December, it was reported that the Election Assistance Commission, the U.S. Election Assistance Commission, which is the federal agency that is responsible for certifying the security of voting system, was also broken into by a Russian hacker, and it was discovered because the hacker was selling the credential into the system on the dark net to a Middle Eastern operative. Earlier this year, the president of the National Association of Secretaries of State called the hacking leading up to this hopefully the death knell for internet voting. And the Alabama Secretary of State suspended the use of his internet voting system before the presidential election, even though it was used in the primary because of this. While there are many states actually have passed laws, as Senator DeSapp has mentioned, to permit online return of voted ballots, most of those laws were passed in that time period when the DOD was working towards a system between 2000 and 2014, and we thought we would see something from them. Just because the laws were passed, we've gone forward, and now we know we can't do it securely yet. Hopefully someday we will in the future. Finally, DHS also opposes online voting in a statement given to a meeting of election officials and other stakeholder groups. DHS said the Cybersecurity Coordination Group does not recommend the adoption of online voting for elections at any level of government at this time. While the convenience of being able to cast a ballot electronically may be appealing, the potential benefits do not outweigh the serious risks associated with online voting. And with regarding the issue of the CAC that was raised,
We're going to have to ask you to wind up.
I'm going to wind
Thank
up.
Thank you so much.
The CAC, there has been an incident in 2015 where emails were hacked, which did use the CAC card, which actually led to the DOD's decision to move on and come up with a different security protocol.
Okay. Thank you so much. Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Alex Blakemore. I'm with Virginia Verified Voting. We're the Virginia affiliate of National Verified Voting. I'm a computer scientist and defense contractor. Spent my entire career building systems for the military. I call your attention to a couple of things. The changes that this bill talks about are much more significant than they appear on the surface. They're basically imposing the same requirements of our entire election on electronic systems. You'll have to verify the identity of the voter, maintain the secrecy of the ballot, the integrity of the ballot, prevent tampering and copying, and keep out hackers. I believe I heard Senator Reeves claim that this bill, I'm not talking about the budget amendment, was a pilot, but if I understand the language in the bill, it doesn't.
Madam Chair, I think Senator Eastoff has a amendment where it's out.
Okay.
So the bill is as introduced, I don't believe it's a pilot. I haven't seen the amendment. So as Susan mentioned, the threats are very real. That state actors attacking election infrastructure, what I see is an act of war. But the IRS, DOD, involved in hacks, Sony, even the CIA, the large banks, JP Morgan was seriously hacked. So there are real threats. The banks their financial systems are able to, they give us the convenience of electronic transactions on the internet by tolerating billions of dollars of fraud every year. We have to have a zero tolerance level for election fraud. The problem is the internet was not designed for security, it was designed for time to market. Security was on purpose left out of the protocol and layered on later. That's what leads to the problems we're facing today. One of the problems there in the security that is there demands giving up secrecy. So when y'all vote today on pushing buttons, and it's a public vote. Everybody can see how you vote. It probably one of the things that influences your vote is that you have to know that you have to be able to defend your vote to your constituents. That makes that issue of making the ballot public simplifies the security measures to a huge degree. But when you require a secret ballot, which the Virginia Constitution requires, it means that all the security measures that banking relies on, and even they get billions of dollars of fraud, can't be used. You can't use receipts. You can't call someone and have them correct your vote after the fact. We can't correct a problem after election day because the system was brought down. We have a problem that's very difficult, more than even the banks with their resources can handle, or the federal government hasn't been able to solve in 15 years. And we expect our state government, which had a hard time this summer even keeping a registration system up, to be able to solve the problem that the federal government couldn't solve. So this is a lot to ask of them. The last point I'll make, because I know time's short, is to remind you all that the Federal MOVE Act, since 2010, has given overseas military and overseas voters 45, they can do everything electronically, except return a cast ballot, the part that has to be secure. They have 45 days to return the cast ballot. The DOD will return it with expedited mail with the tracking number at no cost to the deployed service member. It's a safe and secure system. It's much better than what people remember from prior to 2010. So the enormous costs and risks that this would introduce to solve a problem that we believe Federal LUAC greatly took care of, I think make it the calculus way in favor of rejecting this bill, respectively. So we urge you to protect the integrity of the vote and vote to table this bill. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. And I didn't mean to hurry the previous speaker, but we really do have limited time, and we have a lot of people we want to hear from, and we still have other bills. So thank you very much. Okay, is there anybody else who wishes to speak? Anybody wishes to speak in favor of the bill? Please come forward. Welcome, Colonel. Thank you very much for being here with us.
I'm Jeff Pena, Colonel of the United States Army, retired. And I was tasked this summer to look into this. And I looked into it. And yes, electronic voting can be hacked. There it is. But cyber secure encrypted voting is very, very difficult to be hacked. And we have that at the present time. In previous years, we have been challenged with cybersecurity, and we addressed that with encrypted voting. In fact, there is a company that has just recently been certified by the Department of Defense to provide DOD-level secure systems for voting. And that company is a woman-owned company out of San Diego by the name of Everyone Counts Incorporated. So, encrypted voting is virtually unhackable. Now, if an energetic hacker from wherever he is, or she is, or they are, can hack an encrypted vote. But the time and resources devoted to cracking that encrypted vote is quite time consuming, quite resource consuming, and technology demanding beyond the capability of many, many hackers. That's just a statement. Cost was a driver last year. We have received a rough order of magnitude from Everyone Counts. They can install their ELEC system throughout the Commonwealth, 98 counties, 35 cities, for around $400,000. And finally, count of how many Virginia military stationed overseas throughout the world, 150 postings. And I can speak to that because I have four overseas assignments. And I can tell you that even in the best of 45-day window, the troops call it snail mail. It's not always timely. It certainly isn't efficient. And that's just part of it. We then have a human element at the receiving side. And that human element is subject to inefficiencies. It is subject to other vagaries. Yes, the military vote counts. 45 days may or may not be enough time for them to get their vote back in time. It may or may not guarantee an accurate count. But when you can marry the CAC card until it's replaced with something more robust and interface it with an encrypted voting system, I say it's worth a try.
Madam Chair, the CAC cards, they are going to replace that with something? Is that
a common access card, sir.
But is your understanding they're going to replace that?
Well, there's talk about it, but I haven't seen it being replaced yet. Okay. One more thing. This summer, the director of the FBI stated that the FBI was going to move towards encryption, and I have the quote in the packet that we've distributed to y'all. And in that quote, he says that I'm paraphrasing, he loves encryption, and that that is the safest, most secure way of conducting communications electronically. Notice that I haven't used the term internet, because the internet in many instances is open source, and we're talking about cyber secure encrypted system, a software application that goes far and beyond against hacking. Think of a disenfranchised voter, because his vote didn't get in for whatever reason. He's in a foxhole, he's in a ship afloat, or a ship underfloat. He's in a covert operation, and that ballot may or may not get counted. Are you willing to risk that for someone who puts their life on the line to ensure our votes here in our Commonwealth? Now, let me step aside. I don't want to talk as a member of MOA or JLC. But didn't we read earlier this summer and fall that Governor McAuliffe wanted to give voting rights to 206,000 felons? However well earned those might be, and I don't want to take that away from a deserving felon who has served his time and is a contributing member of the community. I don't want to do that. But my gosh, we count 9,700 Virginia military members abroad, and we can't give them an electronic means for voting? And I'm not using the term internet. Electronic means for voting securely, cyber safe, and encrypted. You know what's the right thing to do? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Herm. Is there anybody else who wishes to speak in favor of the bill? Good afternoon. Welcome.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Jack Gilchrist, United States Marine Corps, retired. Former member of the JLC and the 24 members of that organization which supports this initiative. But I'd also like to point out one thing that Councilman didn't mention. We can allow an astronaut in space to vote electronically. Why can't we allow our defenders of our nation to do so? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, Senator DeStef, would you like, I know you had some comments that you wanted to make in the rebuttal at the end. What would you like to
add? Madam Chair, I'd like to first recommend an amendment. And that would be that we put this into a 24-month pilot program, so 2 years, so we get to a new administration, which I'm a lot more confident would actually do the job. Secondly, Madam Chair, I've been one of those deployed military members who 7 times has not been able to cast my ballot because it would compromise the mission I was on. So we couldn't mail anything back, we didn't get mail. But we did have access to a secure internet and to an unsecured internet. So I'm here to tell you that there's been 7 elections that I missed, And I'd rather that not happen for those who are deployed overseas today. If we can provide it to 206 felons, then I think we should be able to 206,000 felons. And I certainly think we should be able to come up with something for our military.
I'm sure. I think Mr. Carter is working on that amendment, but it might take a few minutes for him to scribe.
So, David, do you have? Are you ready to talk about a line amendment right now?
I have a question about the line amendment. Are we just putting a two-year sunset on the bill? Is that the intention, or?
I would do it as a Madam Chair, if I may. I'd do it as a pilot program, similar to what we did with the joint bill that Dottie Poehler and myself did back 2015, I think it was.
Okay. Senator Deeds.
I would just hope that you have the language broad enough so that this, if this common access card is in fact done away with. I'm looking at an article from this past June with the DOD Chief Information Officer suggested it will be upgraded. It'll be, so the language is broad enough to cover whatever comes next.
And Madam Chair, I'd be happy to do that. I don't know the name of what's coming next. We're referring to the common access card as a unique issue by Department of Defense. So whatever the card or the access card, it's still going to be a common access card. There'll be an upgrade to it, whatever the new name they provide to it. I believe it'll still fall under the definition of common access card.
Madam Chair, can we just have a few minutes for them to work on that and maybe pick up another bill while we're...
Okay. Senator Deans?
I was going to ask, this is not our last meeting.
This is our last meeting, so whatever action we're going to take on any bill, we have to take tonight. Senator Evan, I know you had some questions for the, I think you said maybe the state.
Yeah, is the state, is there anyone from the state board deals with technology, or is that Eduardo here? Who's here?
Madam Chair, I'd also be happy to take this bicep early and address my next bill. I'm going to do it.
Okay, I'm going to let anybody who can respond to Senator Evan, I'm going to let whatever final discussion there may be on this bill, and then we'll move on to your next bill while David continues his work. Good afternoon. Welcome.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm Liz Howard of the Department of Elections. I'm going to
try. I was wondering if your opinion or the department's opinion or past experience or your record, do you have the technology for secure voting that would prevent tampering, hacking, and that would also meet the constitutional requirement for a secret ballot?
Not currently.
Okay. And if we were to install this, is there anything to stop someone from misrepresenting our military's intention and how they vote?
We work with DPB to come up with a FIS for this of several million dollars. So we believe if we get that funded and the system that we would put together, would be able to resist potential attacks that we're aware of now.
Final question.
Senator Evan.
So we think it could resist, but we're not certain that it, I mean, that whatever the next generation of hackers come up with, that it would repel that or be firewall. Okay.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Senator Wheeler, to answer your question, State Board of Elections. While all of us in this room want our military to be able to vote, we want them to be able to vote securely, and our system here on the home front to be as secure. I would offer that the Department of Defense last summer, and I use this word strongly, admonished the voting system that purported itself to be secure was not secure. And the Department of Defense called them out on it because they were advertising that they did have a secure cyber security system. I was at a conference last year in Washington with people in the election community from all over the country. And the person leading the panel on cybersecurity was the head of cybersecurity at MIT. And when asked if we could do any sort of cybersecure voting, his long answer ended by saying, maybe by the end of the century. Right now, it's not, and it cannot be, a secure system, either overseas or when it's returned. The cost is going to be in dollars and cents. I don't think we know what that cost will be. And I want our military to vote. I think it might be a more beneficial idea for the Department of Defense to orchestrate a means by which ballots can be returned in a secure fashion if it's a bag of paper ballots, rather than letting them get lost. I certainly don't want this gentleman to not be able to vote, or he's still deployed. I don't want any of our deployed military to be unable to vote, but I don't want to risk the security of our entire voting system on something that we don't know is secure. Thank you.
Anyone else wish to speak? Okay, we're going to take a sidebar on that, so Mr. Carter can figure out some language for that. Senator DeStef, your second bill you have?
Second bill is Senate Bill 1142. I'd like to take that by for the day, and yes, I understand what by for the day means on this one.
Okay, so without objection, your bill will go by for the day, considering this is the last time we're meeting before crossover.
Thank you very much.
Okay, let me see the list. Senator Howe, you wanna go?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have three bills.
Okay.
Let's do 844, if that's okay.
That'd be fine.
Sorry, I've been up in finance and don't know if you've done other similar bills already. But
okay, committee, bring your attention to Senate Bill 844, please.
This is the No Excuse Absentee Voting Bill. We've seen it several times in the Senate before. It tends to pass the Senate and end up in cool waters on the other side. But this is the bill that says that if you do your in-person absentee voting, you don't have to give an excuse. You still have to go through all of the hoops in terms of showing your photo ID, making sure you're registered, everything that happens on a regular voting day. But you don't have to give one of the many excuses as to why you can't be there on election day. I've watched several times people very distressed because they go, they want an in-person vote, but they don't fit any of the categories. And so then they're forced to lie in order to do what they think is their right, which is to vote. Interestingly, both parties in the past have been suggesting that people do go an in-person absentee vote because there's such lines often at the polling places. So we're putting people in this really difficult position. They don't fit a category, but they want to vote, and they've been directed by their party. Both parties do it, at least in my area. As a way to keep the line short on election day. So that's what this bill does.
So, Senator Howe, this would be a bill that says that one absentee voting precinct would be open 21 days prior all the way to election. So it's probably one, maybe two sites in some counties, I'm not sure.
It varies. There's at least one in, for example, Fairfax County. I think there are about eight or nine.
Okay. Any members of the committee have a question for Senator Howe?
I'm going to interrupt, make a quick comment, go to the back and try to figure out a bill that I have that comes up before this committee in a few minutes. Before we proceed further with the discussion on the bill, I want to take up a procedural issue. This was a bill that was on our docket for the last committee meeting. I know Senator Evans, Senator Dance, Senator Howell, and I all have a bill that is virtually identical. So before we proceed further, you are carrying the water for several other members of this committee. And what we need to do is, I'm going to make a motion that we roll Senate Bill 979. This is with permission of the patrons. And we make everybody a chief co-patron. Senate Bill 979, Senate Bill 1002, and Senate Bill 1295 into your Senate Bill, which is
844.
Which is 844. And I'm going to ask that we roll those bills together. And that motion being made properly seconded, all in favor of rolling bills together. Senator Cosgrove.
Would you mind to ask what they are?
Yes, I'm going to tell you what they are. Yes. But can we roll them together before we get to what they are? So this is a procedural motion. Okay. So what they all do is exactly the bill that she's describing right now, but we're basically just trying to consolidate it so we don't have to hear each one of them separately. They're all... So I'm going to ask for a motion to roll the bills together to incorporate all the bills. All in favor of incorporating the bills, vote aye. Okay, so now the bills are before us as Senate Bill 844. And essentially, to get back to what Senator Howell was saying, and what Senator Evans' bill and Senator Danza's bill does, is seek to address this issue that this committee has been struggling with. And again, I had a bill that is similar or is the same. And that is that we've had people come to us virtually every time this committee has met, looking to address a different set of issues for which a voter encounters that requires them to come and ask for an exception to having to vote on election day. Come in and say, I need to come in and cast an early ballot or an absentee ballot because of this reason. And our list has gotten longer and longer and longer. It was also the case that Senator Sturdivant came recently with a bill that said, if I actually carry a gun, and find myself in a position where I go to a precinct that does not allow me to enter the precinct because I carry a gun, it's a gun-free zone, I want to use that as a reason that I now need to vote early absentee. The bottom line is we are getting to a point where it has become such a long litany of exceptions now that I find myself an advocate of what is the wrong, what is the concern of going in, showing an ID, not having to make up something.
It's
you presenting yourself in person. So with that, that is the explanation of what it is that I think all these bills are seeking to address. And Senator Chase.
Thank you, Madam Chair. As I've mentioned a couple times, I fortunately or unfortunately have been through organizing and very familiar with elections and the technical aspects of this, and I actually really like the bill. The only thing that I'm concerned is from a logistical standpoint. I would want to know the fiscal impact to the localities, because what I've seen, as you know, as the law is written right now, you can show up on the two Saturdays in person before Election Day, and we, this past election, had lines that were wrapped all the way around the building, just for absentee voting. So, we have a lot of logistical issues that I would wonder about with this, to be honest with you. And I would want to make sure that we were adequately prepared. And I can just speak to Chesterfield because that's what I'm most familiar with. And my biggest concern would be if you open that up, and while I agree with the idea of no-excuse voting, my concern is, is there a fiscal impact on this to the localities? And how would we measure that? And are we going to be creating chaos on Election Day and creating a new mess that we, an unintended consequence, if you will?
I neglected to request a line amendment, an amendment to the bill. And I don't know, Senator Howell and I had discussed this, but I know I had discussed it with the registrars. There was an issue with the language of the bill, and that was it makes a reference to Sunday, noon to 4. And I believe that Senator Howell's bill, perhaps Senator Evans' bill, this was an issue that the registrars have raised. I'm not laboring under any misimpression that this is perhaps going to last forever. This bill is going to survive forever and forever. But I know that this is an issue, and this was going to be perhaps a real burden for some of our registrars, the issue of the Sunday noon to 4. So if I had the committee's indulgence, that was something that I meant to address earlier, and I forgot. So David, is that something that you could pull up and that we could, I could make the motion to do a line amendment where it makes a reference to Sunday noon to 4?
Madam Chair?
Senator,
allow the vote on Sunday?
Well, so the issue was we were going to strike that and not have the registrars have to allow for that voting on Sunday from noon to 4, because that's a hardship for everybody.
I would second that.
Yes, right, and it's a church time. And that was something that Legislative Services had included, and that was not my intention. Senator Chapin.
I just have a comment that I haven't heard expressed, and it's been running through my head as we listen to these concepts of expanding absentee voter rights. And, you know, in the last presidential election, we were all the specter of news changing, things changing, attitudes changing, finding out things about candidates you didn't know, right up to the buzzword. And what we do as a policy, when we think about changing these game changers by giving people the right to go in mass, weeks ahead of the polls, we have them voting on the candidate that they know at that time. Maybe not the candidate that might be there on election day or the news that might be there on election day. And so when I think about that and how that things can change, I don't feel good about changing our laws to the point where everyone could vote absentee, because we might not be voting for the candidate we thought we were voting for.
Senator Chapin, I'll just respond by saying I actually don't disagree. The challenge that I have is that as people have approached me with requests to add different exceptions, and it comes up over and over and over, I have found myself with this real quandary of, well, you know, at what point do you stop? And so this was something that I have also struggled with, and I agree. So is there anybody else, any other member of the committee who wishes to comment? I'm going to ask, is there anybody in the audience who wishes to speak in opposition to the bill? Well, don't storm the podium. Is there anybody in the audience who wishes to speak in favor of the bill? Please come forward. Welcome.
Madam Chair, Liz Howard with the Department of Elections, and we support this bill for the reasons on the stage. So, I hope I'm asking about the ACLU of Virginia, and it's qualified support, so a little bit of a mixture. We would like to see true reform to Virginia's absentee voting laws. We would like the extension to be both by in-person and by mail. And there's some real reasons why. We continue to think that if Virginia limits it to in-person, we're really discounting qualified voters who, for participating in our system, based on the lack of accessible transportation to the general registrar's office, geography, income status, and the constraints of modern-day society, individuals, and families. There are many people who don't have the luxury of working 9 to 5 and having Saturdays off to go vote absentee in person. If this were extended to mail, this would be truly true reform, at least in our opinion. Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Senator Sproul.
Ladies and gentlemen, I heard what you're saying, but if this thing goes through, you'll get what you can get, you know.
And we completely understand that, but the ACLU of Virginia is first in these sorts of positions.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, I'm not understanding your question.
Okay. Welcome.
Good afternoon, Madam Chairwoman. My name is Ellen Bolo. I represent the
Fairfax County Board of Supervisors. We support this bill, and we have some additional information from our General Registrar.
Welcome, Mr. General Registrar.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, as well as members of the committee. A couple things about this bill, definitely supportive. I think most importantly, from my standpoint, if you show up in my office before Election Day, meet all the requirements to vote an absentee ballot, I don't care where you're going to be or what you're going to be doing on Election Day, and I don't think it is the business of government at any time to ask you where you're going to be and what you're going to be doing if you've already proven your eligibility to cast a ballot. That's number one. Number two, in terms of potential fiscal impact, we could possibly see a positive impact of Fairfax County. As Senator Howell mentioned, we operate 10 satellite locations for absentee voting. The reduction in the number of days for each of those satellite locations down to 21 will actually give us a net savings on some of this operations. Only thing I'd ask is be considered possibly, I'm not certain if the bill does strictly prohibit it to starting in-person absentee on the 21st day. If there's some opportunity to begin it earlier, within the 45 days, we'd like that as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Chase.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just a note that I just wanted to make. I actually, there are parts of this bill that I really do like, and as you know from one of the bills that passed out of the Senate, we had a photo ID bill that passed out of the Senate that required a picture ID in the instances of absentee voting. We also had a bill, I believe it was Senator Obenshain, brought to the committee that would basically allow the DMV to transfer those pictures to the registrars. So I see this as a lot of reform that needs to take place all at one time. We need to have the ability to verify IDs as they come in so that we have a valid picture coming from the DMV. And then we also have a law in place that says you have to present your ID. And I think once that's in place, I would be in favor of something like this 21 days prior to the election, because it's an easier process for the registrars. They have the picture there from the DMV. They have the person presenting the ID, and they can come up with 21 days. The process will be quick and seamless. So I see this as a great opportunity. I don't think it's ready for prime time today, but I do feel like this is a piece of the reform. And for that reason, for this year, I'm going to move to PDI this bill.
Okay, the motion has been made and properly seconded to pass by Senate Bill 844 indefinitely.
Madam Chair?
Senator Dean.
Substitute motion.
Substitute motion.
Move to report with the amendment.
Second.
And I need to clarify, Senator Howell's bill is perfect. Didn't need the amendment. Mine was the one.
Okay. So it doesn't have to.
Okay, it's almost perfect.
It does need one amendment.
Okay. So David Carter, our resident expert, is going to make it perfect before it lives or dies.
Madam Chair, on line 43, the bill uses the term electoral board, but it meant general registrar, so we need to strike that and put it in general registrar.
Okay, so there's a line amendment. Senator Daines moves and Senator Spool seconds a line amendment to make the correction to change it to general registrars. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Okay. The bill, as amended, is now before us with a substitute motion made by Senator Dance and seconded by Senator
Evan.
That the bill be reported. All in favor of reporting Senate Bill 844, please vote aye. Nay, same sign. Aye 7, nay 7, the bill fails to report.
Reverse it. The bill fails to PBI.
Madam Chairman, I move to report the bill. Is that 5 minutes in
the time? The substitute was to report.
Okay.
It's just a motion that stays. It just stays there.
It's just, it comes with the same damage.
So, John, withdraw your original motion now. We're back to you.
Right.
Withdraw your original motion.
Withdraw your motion.
I withdraw my motion.
There you go.
Actually, I'd like to make a motion that we report.
Okay, so the motion is to report the bill. All in favor of reporting Senate Bill 844, please vote aye or nay.
Jesus Christ.
Aye 7, nay 7, the bill fails to report.
I'd like to move that we get another member of the committee so we've not.
That was Bill 844, draft, right?
Yes.
Two
okay. Thank you very much, Senator.
I have other bills.
Yes, I know you do. So, next on your list, you get to choose which one you want to do.
Oh, thank you. It's 845.
Okay, Senate Bill 845.
Fearing that getting rid of all excuses might not make it through the whole process, I put in another bill, and let me tell you how I got this bill. This will add yet another excuse. A constituent of mine contacted me very upset because she had a friend who really needed help, was physically very ill, and he moved in to her house and she was taking care of him. And he needed an operation on election day. So she wanted to vote absentee, and there is a provision in the code that caregivers of family members can have an in-person absentee vote, but this was not a family member, this was a dear friend. So she wasn't able to vote, well, she didn't lie, I guess is what happened, like most people do. So she wasn't able to do the in-person absentee voting. So I am trying to just add that a caregiver, any caregiver, whether or not you're a family member, can have an excuse to in-person absentee vote.
Okay, is there any member of the committee who has a question of the patron? I think everybody understands this. Completely. Mr. Senator Cosgrove.
Mr. Senator, you say any caregiver, that can be any parent, right?
Well, a parent, Madam Chairman,
yes,
if a parent they're a family member, so they're already covered. This is the situation where the caregiver is not a family member.
Is there any member of the audience who wishes to speak in opposition to the bill? Is there any member who wishes to speak in support of the bill? Okay. I'll let you say one quick word in support because we have a motion to report the bill, but go ahead.
Hi. Michael Lewinson, the Thompson, do support the bill because some caregivers that work with people with disabilities, they may not be able to get there on the day off.
Right. Thank you very much. Okay. Senator Deeds. Senator Deeds has moved and Senator Sproul has seconded reporting Senate Bill 845. All in favor of reporting the bill vote aye and nay same sign. Okay, so that was a better choice, Senator Sproul. The bill reports unanimously. Okay, next.
And then you and I have a Bill 879. Would you like to do that one?
This is yet another redistricting bill, and this is a criteria bill. We have heard this about 11 different ways, and this is to codify the criteria, and it does the criteria in the identical way that Senator Howell and I had done it as a constitutional amendment. It just simply does it in the code. And so with that, I would make the motion that we report the bill.
Second.
And people who like redistricting reform are going to like it, and people who don't are not going to like it. So there's no point in talking it to death. So the motion's been made and properly seconded to report Senate Bill 878. All in favor, please signify by voting aye, and nay, same sign. Ayes 7, nays 7. I tell you, we're just never consistent. So the bill fails to report. But we have other vehicles. Alas, we have other vehicles. Thank you, Senator Howe. Okay, Senator DeStef, your bill is now fully baked with its, David, are you ready for Senator DeStef? Are you ready to...
Madam Chair, if I may, okay. The amendment to the amendment in nature of a substitute to Senate Bill 1390.
Okay, Senator Reeves moves and Senator Chaffin seconds the adoption of the substitute for Senate Bill 1490. All in favor of adopting the substitute, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, now the substitute is properly before us. Senator DeStef.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. What the amendment in nature of substitute does is for those who are deployed without access to United States mail, who are applying for casting military overseas to sign a ballot, basically it puts a pilot program in effect for 2 years or to be executed on in July of 2019. I'm sorry, that's a sunset. So basically, this puts together a pilot program to see if we can actually execute on providing electronic voting for deployed military who do not have access to U.S. mail when deployed.
Okay. Madam Chair.
Senator Deeds.
Senator Steph, do you have a budget amendment for this bill?
There is a Senator Reeves has a budget amendment for this bill. Madam Chair.
Madam Chair, I was just a little concerned when... we got testimony that there's not enough money to do this, and there's not the technology. Man, I'm interested in the pilot project out the technology that's apparently available in San Diego, but I'm interested in how much money this is going to
cost. Senator Reeves.
We put in a budget amendment based off the initial projections we got from JLC on that, so I don't know what the status is of the budget amendment of the finance.
How much
is it?
$400,000. Okay, so we'll have to go to finance to these here. Yes. Mm-hmm. This budget amendment is actually before my subcommittee in finance, and it's currently.
Madam Chair, I move to report the substitute and report finance.
Okay, the motion has been made properly seconded to report Senate Bill 1490. Madam Chair. Senator Cosgrove.
I'm a little concerned about the verbiage on line 41. I'm not sure exactly what that says.
And if I may, Madam Chair, I think I can clarify.
Okay. Line 41. You want to respond to Senator Cosgrove's request for clarification?
I believe the clarification you're looking for is without access to U.S. mail, correct, Senator Cosgrove?
No, and who is applying for or casting the military at overseas, assigning the military cash overseas ballot application.
Should be a ballot.
Sign the military overseas. If you strike the second one, to sign military overseas, then it goes back to the original intent, which is for casting military overseas ballot application.
Okay.
Do is on line 41.
where it says, who is applying for or casting a military overseas ballot? Had the word ballot there.
You need to insert the word ballot after the words overseas and before the word to. That's what you have to do. That's exactly it. Okay, so that's the motion. The line amendment is to line 41 to insert the word ballot after overseas and before the word to. The motion has been made by Senator Cosgrove and properly seconded by Senator Edwards. All in favor of the line amendment, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Now, line 41 now makes sense.
Yeah. Madam Chair, move to report and refer.
Okay. Now, as amended, Senate Bill 1490, the motion has been made and properly seconded to report Senate Bill 1490 and re-refer to finance. All in favor, please vote aye or nay. Same sign. Okay, the ayes are 9, nays 5, and the bill reports and is re-referred to finance. Okay. Mr. Clerk. Who else has a bill other than myself? I have one. Oh, Senator Peek.
I
have 3. You have 3.
I have 3. Should I go? Oh, you up? No.
You guys can fight it out. You can go whichever order you wish.
Gosh. I'll probably go after Senator Cosgrove. He's going to be here anyway. Good afternoon, Madam Chair.
Good afternoon.
I would like to start with Senate Bill 1567, which, well, Senator Howell has gone now, she would like part of this is entitling people who are older than 65 to request an absentee ballot without any excuse.
Madam Chair, is this the same bill Senator Miller carried for years?
Yes, this is the same bill Senator Miller carried, and I believe we heard this bill last week. It's identical to the bill that we heard last week, which was Senate Bill 792. Is that correct? And that was Senator...
It's Senator Overchain with this one. I believe is a little different.
Okay.
Because it's allowing anybody 65 or older to apply for an absentee ballot without excuse, but it is requiring a photo ID. And that's the difference.
It's also...
Yes, Senator Evan.
Does that also require a photo ID for students who are...
It does for that. It includes that as well, and for students.
So by mail?
Anybody voting absentee by mail would have to include some form of photo ID that is acceptable under the statute to vote absentee by mail. And that is the bill.
Mr. Chairman.
Senator Edwards.
The obvious question, what's the registrar's office supposed to do with this photograph?
Compare it with the name, yes. At least have a name and full name, address,
and
photo ID.
Mr. Chairman, talking to registrars, they have no idea what they're supposed to do. You got a photograph, they don't know the person.
Well, then
name,
we have...
And throw it away. You trash it.
Madam Chair. Senator Edwards, there's also other bills from Senator Overchain allowing the registrars to access DMV voter information so they could then prepare those photographs.
Mr. Chairman, suppose you have an older person who's given up their license, they're living in a retirement community, and I've seen this happen, they apply for an absentee ballot, and they don't necessarily keep a photograph of themselves. They don't have a driver's license anymore. They have no reason to keep a photograph. We know Medicare doesn't have a photograph on their card. They just don't keep photographs hanging around. And what are they supposed to do? They don't have a copy machine. You know, all you're doing is making it difficult for older people.
Well, then they're going to need their photo ID at some point to go vote at the registrar or in person. So, yeah, that's my bit.
Mr. Chairman, we're talking about absentee ballots. Don't you see some illogical feature here?
I do not.
Okay, is there anybody in the audience who wishes to speak against the bill? Welcome, Cameron.
Madam Chairman, Cameron Sassett, General Register of Fairfax County. We put this bill, we think that there's going to be a slight fiscal impact just with the logistics of the bill. People sending in copies of their IDs, the number of correspondents that have to go out telling people that their applications were not accepted because they did not include them. Then also the number of IDs that we receive in the mail regularly, the physical IDs, we'd be mailing those back to people as well. So we anticipate a cost impact to the county of Fairfax in terms of correspondence.
Madam Chair, Liz Howard, the Department of Elections. We oppose this bill for the reason alluded to by Senator Edwards earlier. Having a photo ID in absentee voting will not serve its purpose.
Madam Chair.
Senator Chase.
As you all know, I'm very much in support of photo ID for absentee. And I would like to know if the gentleman would like to include his bill in with mine and be a chief patron.
Yeah, that would be fine. Let's roll it in.
One of my biggest concerns is I don't want to appear that we're picking on one particular group over another. The one that passed the Senate. It already passed.
You can't roll it in.
So what do we do at that point?
I don't think I was. We did not roll it in because we weren't sure if yours would pass.
Right. Yeah. And we can't roll it in because it deals with a different subject matter, which is of people who are 65 and older also. So you can sign on as a co-patron.
This is a little different. We'll see if this is going to go for yours, and they go for the 65.
Sure. I guess my only concern is that I don't want to pick on one particular.
I'm not trying to pick on anybody. We were trying to make it easier for those 65 and over to vote absentee. And in exchange for doing that, we just want a little assertion that they are the actual ballots, the actual people, because of what happened in Harrisonburg.
Oh, I completely agree.
So that's the reasoning for the bill.
Okay. The committee operates on a motion. I'll move to report. Is there a second? Okay. Bill has been moved and properly seconded that we report Senate Bill 1567. All in favor, please vote aye.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
You sure?
What the heck?
Did I pass?
Seven. It's 7 ayes and 7 nays. So the bill fails to report. Okay. Having voted on the reconsider.
Madam Chair, if she voted no?
There wasn't a bail inside.
Senator Pete, do you have another bill? Senate Bill 1571, this involves special elections. And, you know, we have had some experience with special elections. This requires the registrar to certify the election. The State Board of Elections to certify the election within 3 days of the special election. Assuming that if there are any provisional ballots out there, that if there is not enough provisional ballots to affect the election, to go ahead and certify the election within 3 days. And the local electoral board shall meet and count and certify their elections, regardless of whether or not one of those days is a federal, state,
okay. I can see why you would make that request.
I would report that. You might have the same problem. I'm going to report.
Okay. Senator Evan.
If I could just ask a question, please.
Sir.
Senator, what would be the difference if, say, you had 20 precincts and you count 19 of the precincts and you're ahead by 90%?
That's different. Yeah, that's precincts. This is, Madam Chair.
Yes, go ahead.
This was a special election happened on January 10th. All the ballots were in, all the precincts had reported. One of the candidates was up by 3,400 some votes. There were 9 provisional ballots. So, and that, and And that could have been General, that could have been Senator McClellan, could have been Senator Spruill, could have been somebody else. But if they're not provisional ballots and they're up by 4,000, that's not the same as if all the precincts have not voted. All the precincts have to vote. This only affects provisional ballots.
Okay, I appreciate the distinction. I just, I understand the distinction. I just feel like everyone's vote should be counted before the results are final.
Okay. Is there anybody in the audience who wishes to speak on this bill?
Pursuant to the missteps of being kind in Lynchburg this year, the special elections would not be affected as this bill provides. Again, Senator Evans, the provisional ballots will be counted, but there are not sufficient numbers of provisional ballots to change the results. So if you candidate who has won by 3,000 votes, if you have nine provisionals, the nine provisionals will still be counted. And so the total number of votes cast for a candidate in the final analysis will be recorded. But in order to provide that citizens of Virginia have representatives when the General Assembly seats, we want to be able to go ahead and do it expediently. In point of fact, both the chairman of the elected board and I spoke and said, we'll come in any time and certify the elections. You only need two members, and I'm sure the secretary would have come also. But we did not have that option under the code, or we didn't think we had that option under the code. And it delays people getting into their committees. And I think this is a very good bill because it counts everybody's ballot.
And my final question, Madam Chair.
Senator Evan.
How long does it take to certify election now?
Well, this took over a week. The most recent special election took over a week. Okay. The election was on Tuesday, and certification was done the following Wednesday.
Okay.
But all the ballots and all the precincts reported that night, and then the next day, the temporary. And then the next day, all of the electoral boards in all of the locations where there was an election certified their results to the state board. So technically, the next day, the state board could have met and certified the election.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Senator Cosgrove.
Question for the next lady that's just there.
Yes, sir.
Is there any statutory time limit that the state board has to follow in order to certify an election?
You mean, do you have to do it within a certain amount of time?
Right.
There is, and I can't tell you what it is off the top of my head. I'm sorry. I should have had that information. But it's not the next day. I mean, it could be 2 weeks.
Well,
Senator Cosgrove.
In my case, I had a special election, and they were going to do it, take it off 2 weeks.
Exactly.
And it was a tiny little election.
Right. This helps everybody get to their positions for which they've done a lot of
work. Okay. I'd like to move to report the motion been made and properly seconded that we report Senate Bill 1571. All in favor, please vote aye. Don't take it personally. Okay. It all comes out in the wash.
And I must say thank you. I now have a bill that is going to pass because my only other bill was a septic bill, and I really just want to have something septic bill.
Hey, it might be your most,
it might be most
efficient, productive bill so far.
Final bill, Senate Bill 1581, and this is to verify voter registrations with Social Security numbers. When people come to register, they give their Social Security numbers, and then our registrars need to be able to check these Social Security numbers and make sure that the person registering is a real person. This person has that Social Security number. This is to protect our voting system.
Madam Chair.
Senator Cosgrove.
We just dealt with a bill for the patron one shall thus use just the last four. It was my understanding that the Social Security number is already required for voter registration.
It is required. We want to be able to check them. What you have now is the registrars can't check them. So now we're going to allow them to check the Social Security number. Because now they can give, Madam Chair, now they can give fake Social Security numbers and the registrars don't verify it. This gives them the authority to verify it somehow.
Madam Chair?
Sir. Okay, Senator's floor.
Now, so the first one, you're going to have a picture ID. Name will have a registration card. Now, they're already backed up. The plane already across the state. It takes too long. So you're trying to get people in there vote early. You don't want that, so I can't come in and vote early, but yet you definitely more stuff on us to verify. You got to have a picture. You have a Social Security card, but you want it to come in and vote early. This can take all day long.
Madam Chairman, Senator Spruill, this is not for voting. This is when you register to vote that you need to have your Social Security. You actually have to have your Social Security now. So we're not changing that. So when you register to vote, you have to give your Social Security number. That's already required. This just allows the registrar to check that Social Security and make sure it's accurate.
Is there a budget impact on this bill?
There was not. Budget amendment necessary? No.
Sorry, I apologize.
I'd be happy to.
I was having a sidebar with the registrar over Senator Deed's earlier bill, and we've resolved it, so I just saved us an extra 20 minutes.
Madam Chair, okay. I could ask Sarah Pete's question.
Yes, Senator Evans.
And I do want to find a bill yours that we can vote up, that I can vote for, even
close. I bet this it will be it.
This may not be it. My question is, are we guaranteed that the Federal Social Security Administration will provide our state board with that information?
We are not.
So, because it says, if I read it correctly, it says the general registrar shall verify it, shall match the information on file with the Social Security Administration or other database approved by the state board. But if we can't get access, if this Federal Social Security Administration is probably concerned with data breach, won't give all of our separate boards of elections access to their files. How do you do that?
Madam Chair, and that's what we're hoping. That's why we have more other approved DMV, possibly Medicaid, Medicare, whatever other state organizations have Social Security numbers.
The DMV has someone's full social.
I believe they do.
And what if someone?
They just don't put it on your driver's license.
Okay, but. Then finally, what would happen if someone doesn't have a state DMV authorized ID with a, there are some people, I presume, who may not have a state ID or something where the state retains their social?
And it allows them to check it in, and I don't have in the bill, and that's because it's going to have to be amended at some point. As to who has all the Social Security numbers, then if you cannot check it through Social Security Administration, and they are not registered with any state, then we'll have to come up with another way for them to verify that Social Security number.
Okay.
And it may not be that they're disqualified, but this certainly gives us the ability to check.
Well, just to clarify, it says before registering any applicant, the general registrar shall verify the name, date of birth, and Social Security. Like, for my date of birth, if I didn't have Virginia ID, you'd have to go to another state to get my birth certificate, I guess.
You have to get your birth certificate.
But how would you verify my date of birth if I wasn't in the DMV database?
Then we may be able to do it with Social Security Administration, so we pass the bill.
I'm just a little doubtful that they'll give us the database access to their state data, to their database, to 130 different registrars.
Madam Chair, Senator Chase.
I would like to speak in favor of the bill, and I would like to make a general comment. I had our registrar Larry Hickey, to bring to me a report, and I was looking to have that in my hand. It's up in my office, and I don't have it with me, and I regret that.
But in there, it's a report that basically states that that is one of the main issues that in Chesterfield they've seen is Social Security numbers that are submitted but are not correct. They're fraud. That's how the fraud is. Correct. So that is a legitimate issue. And as far as verification, I don't know, maybe Clarabelle Wheeler could speak to how they verify using the Social Security number, if they had that ability to verify, how that would work.
Okay, anybody who wishes to speak?
Okay.
Senator Spool, you need to go with your question first.
If you go to the restroom and you have your picture ID, and as pretty as you are, and I see your picture ID, why am I with the Social Security number to verify it's you? I look at my picture and say, hey, it's you. Look just like you. So why I have a Social Security number? I see it's you. I got your picture ID. It's your picture. So why are you there for? Your picture ID says you.
Madam Chair, but that doesn't mean that she's a citizen. Just because doesn't mean she's a citizen of the United States eligible to vote. That we're talking about registering to vote, not voting at the voting. That voter ID, no, it's not. Anyway, so not
okay. Anybody wishes to speak? Go ahead.
Madam Chair, Liz Howard of the Department of Elections. We oppose this bill. Just to be clear, we already engage in Social Security number verification now. The DMV has an agreement with the Social Security Administration, so they conduct the Social Security number verification for us for the vast majority of the voter registrations that are submitted. And so some of our concerns relate to what you suggested earlier, Senator Evan. We don't know that the Social Security Administration would agree to provide us this information. And just to be clear, they asked about the fiscal impact earlier. I believe we said it was indeterminate because we don't know whether or not they would sign an agreement with us, so we were unable to price it.
Clarabelle Wheeler, I think I want her to comment on.
2 points. This is about, to your question, such throw, it's about voter registration. This has no impact at all with someone going in to vote because you've already been registered. This is to try to correct, and the deputy commissioner is correct. The DMV is supposed to check the Social Security numbers. And so if someone has a DMV record, the DMV should have verified, should have, being the operative phrase, should have verified the Social Security number. It doesn't always happen. The example of the student who was trying to register people in Harrisonburg, by making up, that's imaginary, Social Security numbers. If a registrar goes into Veris today to register someone, they type in the name, the birth date, and the full Social Security number. As long as that Social Security number is not attached to a registered voter in Virginia, then that person is registered to vote. If it's an imaginary Social Security number, it's not going to appear, unless there are two imaginary people with the same Social Security number. In the past, so we need to have a clear verification method for Social Security numbers. In the past, within the last 5 years, the Department of Elections actually paid a third-party vendor to verify Social Security numbers. I mean, the same as third-party vendors when you try to get a credit card. You put your Social Security number in it, they go right into the Social Security Administration and say, yep, that's who it is. Same social, same birth date, same name. Must be that person. We need that for verification for our voters so that we know we're not registering imaginary people or we're not registering people who are dead and by Social Security number. Because if you have a Social Security number and you die, then that Social Security number goes into disuse. It's taken out of the system for an extensive period of time, and then because of the numbers of people, they come back into use. But the Social Security number, the Social Security Administration does that. There are means of checking, as the Deputy Commissioner said. there are means of checking the Social Security number, and for the registrars, it would be a look-only mechanism. They wouldn't be able to type in to the Social Security Administration and say, give me all your Social Security numbers. They would say, Claire Bell Wheeler, born whatever date, whatever Social Security number, boom, is that correct? And they'll say, yep, that Social Security number is attached to that person born on that day. Or, no, we don't have that Social Security number anywhere. Or, yes, we have that Social Security number, but it's attached to John Jones. Or it's attached to Claire Bell Wheeler, but her birthday's off by 10 years. If it's younger, I'll take it. So the mechanism is there. It may be through a third party. It may be through the DMV. It may be something as simple as the registrars being able to go into the Social Security Administration, but we want to be able to give them that ability to do it.
Madam Chair?
On the fly. Yes,
ma'am.
Senator Crowe.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Going to a third party, is there an impact?
Well, when they did it, when the department used a third party before, it was $5,000 to check all the Social Security numbers. And that comes from the former Secretary of the State Board of Elections, Don Palmer.
How long would it have been?
Within the last 5 years. And it should have been still, I'm not sure why it's not still being done.
Senator Cosgrove.
I'm moving to report.
Okay. The motion's been made and properly seconded. Cameron, did you want to say literally one sentence?
I'll be just very quick. I think we definitely, as registrars, need more tools to be able to do the process and making sure that our roles are accurate and complete. However, I think just technically, this bill is not sound. I think that there are ways that you can achieve this by incorporating into other sections of the code, such as 404, which authorizes the department to have information for the purposes of list maintenance. However, I do feel that the way that this bill is currently structured, it puts a significant onus locally on having to verify information before actually putting it in the registration, when that can be actually be incorporated in one process.
Okay, the motion has been made properly seconded. All in favor of reporting Senate Bill 1581, please vote aye. Okay, it's 8 yeas, 5 nays. The bill reports. Okay, Senator Cosgrove, we are nearing the end. How many are left? I've lost track.
You have two and Ms. Peters.
And then the four total. Okay.
Madam Chair, I have a Senate Bill 821.
Okay, direct your attention to Senate Bill 821, please.
Privileges and elections are in this bill numerous times. This is party identification bill on your registration. And I believe Senator Openshain has a bill very similar to this. Basically, what it does is add party affiliation beginning on January 1st, 2018, to the information that the applicant has to provide when registering to vote. So, in very brief terms, when you register to vote, say, are you a Republican? Democrat, or are you an independent?
Didn't we have a bill?
We had one that dealt with local elections. That was one that we heard from earlier, where that was just for local elections. This deals with party registration for everybody.
Thank you.
Okay. Go ahead, Senator Cosgrove.
Thank you, Madam Chair. If a person declines to call themselves any one of those three options, they will be carried as an independent. And then the political parties who have primaries or whatever can go by their own rules and have that association. If you're a Republican on your registration, you can vote in a Republican primary. If you are an independent on your registration, you can vote in that Republican primary. But if you're a Democrat, you cannot. Alternately, if you're a Democrat, you can vote in a Democrat primary. If you're an independent who hasn't voted in the Republican primary, then you can vote in that Democrat primary. But if you're a Republican, you cannot. So it really is just an association by a political party. People that want to be independent can be independent, but I think this is a truth in advertising bill, if nothing else.
Madam Chair.
Senator Sproul.
I'm surprised, Ms. John. Did I not vote for you in the primary?
Is there anybody in the audience who wishes to speak in favor of the bill? Is there anybody who wishes to speak in opposition to the bill? Is there anybody? I was going to say, is there anybody who has a question? Is there a motion?
Motion to report.
Okay. Motion's been made, properly seconded to report Senate Bill 821. All in favor? Signify by saying aye. Or reporting aye. Seven ayes, six nays. Bill reports. Okay. Who else? Okay. I'll get mine. Okay. Senator Peterson had a bill, and Rules has requested it. I can't speak any longer. And so I'm going to make the motion that we refer Senate Bill 1593 directly to the Rules Committee. Motion has been made, properly seconded. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, that's been sent to Rules. Who else is here who has a bill? Sorry, we're going to vote electronically. Sorry, the clerk wishes us to vote properly and electronically. 1593. Okay, Rules. Is there any?
This was just sent one up.
Okay. I have a bill that I will do very quickly. This might get more complicated than I wish it to get, but we'll make it work with this. I have Senate Bill 1547. I believe it is the case that most people in the Commonwealth of Virginia, and in fact, most people on this committee, believe that it was already the case that it was not legal in the Commonwealth of Virginia to use your campaign funds for personal use. I don't believe it is the case that anybody believes it's ethical. I don't believe it's the case that anybody who is a currently elected office holder maintains that as their practice. There are only three states in the country that do not make it clear in the code that you cannot use your campaign funds for personal use, or that you cannot convert them for personal use. It's very clear it's a crime under federal law to do that. And it was interesting because I had somebody email me recently, and it's something that's so obscure that I was surprised that somebody sent me a note about it. They sent me an email and they said they couldn't believe in the Commonwealth of Virginia that this was the case, and they went on to illustrate some issues and raise some cases where this had allegedly occurred. So what I have done is I have introduced Senate Bill 1547 that just makes it clear that you can't raise money for your campaign and pay your mortgage with it or take your family on vacation. It shouldn't be controversial. I think anybody who holds themselves out as a candidate for public office and serves in public office and holds a public trust, that should be a commitment that we make to the public and to those that we represent. That we hold those funds and trust. Senator Edwards.
The definition is personal use. What about using campaign money to pay your staff or expand your staff to provide services to the public?
I knew you were going to ask that question. And so this is drawn very narrowly. Some states have very, very broad definitions. Mine is drawn very narrowly. I'm going to actually ask that the committee adopt a substitute that I have introduced. It's a little narrower, and I think that the committee would have more of an appetite for this. So I'm going to distribute the committee substitute.
Madam Chair?
Senator Sproul.
Can you do that now? Let's say, for example, part of my district, I have a new partisan in Norfolk. And what I do, once a month, we have a committee staff in Norfolk, and I pay for it myself as a campaign. I can even roughly meet me, and some of the Norfolk. It's a new territory to me. So once a month, I'm going to put roughly, and I pay for the campaign. What about that?
So that would be appropriate. So let me just clarify that that the definitions that are described in the bill that you have before you are very narrow. So the kinds of things that you ordinarily raise money and you pay for out of your campaign account, like for staff to run your office, for office space, or maybe furniture for your office, for taking your steps to lunch. Those are the kinds of things that you might pay for now. Those would be totally appropriate, because those would be the kinds of things that you use to run your, maybe your office. Yes, I move that we adopt the substitute. Substitute's been moved and properly seconded. All in favor of adopting the substitute, please vote aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Okay, so now the substitute's properly before you. Senator Deeds.
Second.
Okay, so the bill's been moved.
I want more of an explanation.
Yeah, okay.
Madam Chair, I have a question here.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't had a chance to review the substitute just yet, but looking at the prior bill, where it talks about...
let me just make sure. Don't look at the prior bill. What you need to look at is the substitute, which is identical to Senator Cole's bill that was introduced on the House side.
Does this say anything about immediate family? Because I just know one of my kids is going to run for office. And I'm going to want to use my PAC money to give it to them when they run for office.
So what you can do is you can take your money and you can make a contribution to their candidate committee, which would be totally appropriate. But what you cannot do is pay for their college education.
Correct.
You cannot buy them clothes. You cannot take them on vacation.
Madam Chair, I just said, say to Senator Chase, look at 30-101. Okay. Look at the definition of immediate family and personal use. I mean, we're only talking, this bill, I think, is just talking about things that none of us really think should be used for campaign dollars. They are going to be things, uses that the people that contribute to us expect us to use them for.
Well, and I will tell you, it really does shock the conscience of most people when they consider that out of 50 states, there are only three, that have not made this perfectly clear. And Virginia is one of the three that has not actually put it in code that it is not legal to raise campaign money and spend it on yourself or your family. And I think it is something that most people, and certainly all of us who are elected householders, have operated under the assumption that it's not legal.
Madam Chair, I have one quick
Senator
question,
Steph.
And just looking for clarification. If a member were running for statewide candidacy and they used campaign money to pay their child who was driving them around to meetings throughout the state, would that be restricted here or accepted here, acceptable here?
That's paying for legitimate good or service for real consideration, for actual consideration, for a true good or service that would be a campaign service. That would not be conversion for personal use. That wouldn't be anything that that a reasonable person would consider, violate the reasonable person standard that would consider that being conversion. So you're not buying clothes with it. It's a legitimate campaign expense.
And where is that in the bill?
If you look, line 42 to 44.
In the substitute.
If you look at the substitute that's been distributed, if you go to line 42, reimbursements paid to the candidate or a member of his immediate family in accordance with Section 24 of the law, and payments for goods and services provided to the campaign by a member of the candidate's immediate family shall not be considered an unlawful conversion of contributions to the personal use of the candidate or a member of the candidate's immediate family. I will just tell you, as somebody who's very familiar with what most states have passed, or what all states have passed, I have drawn this very narrowly with the expectation that my colleagues would all have concerns, because everybody runs campaigns, raises money for their candidate committees and uses that candidate committee money to help support the day-to-day management expenses of their Senate offices. So to be clear, I was not looking to unwittingly catch anybody who might use their campaign resources to compensate somebody that works for their office, compensate somebody that works for their campaign. I'm trying to be very, very careful not to catch anybody, but to also be very, very clear about what we believe the ethics law should be in Virginia. We've made a big to-do about the ethics standards in the Commonwealth of Virginia, and we have left a gaping hole where I think the ethics standards should be for conversion of campaign funds for personal use. You should not be able to buy clothes or go on vacation with your campaign money.
Madam
Period.
Chair, I want to commend you for this bill. It fills a necessary goal. And I want you, it's even very generous. Look at the language on lines 45 and 46. It recognizes that a lot of legislators use the office they use for their regular business. They also use for dual purpose of the campaign.
Right.
I renew my motion.
Thank you, Senator Evan.
Yeah, Madam Chair, this is a great bill. I do have a question, or two questions. One, on line 48 to 49, it says that you can't act on a complaint brought by anyone who was not a contributor. Is that right? So, in other words, if I know that if someone knows that I'm going to buy, groceries or whatever it is with my campaign money, but they're not a contributor in my campaign, the state board can't really act on that. Is that right?
That is actually correct.
I don't know how strong you feel about that, or the committee does. I personally think it'd be better to.
I think I'll be honest with you. This is not something that I felt strongly about. This is something that's borrowed language from another patron. I was careful to try to draw this in such a narrow way that I felt like I would have success with the bill, that it would resolve all the issues of, for example, in this case, I think standing, really. Are you just going to create an opportunity where by passing what I consider an ethics or an ethics bill here, that then everybody would say, well, here's this issue now. Suddenly it's going to be used for somebody with bad will here is going to be throwing it up against the wall to see what will stick and attack candidates who are running for office and, pick through their campaign report. That in this regard, you'd be restricting it to legitimate people who would arguably have standing, to pursue a candidate by looking through the report and saying, look, I feel like my money was misused. I personally am not wedded to that piece of this. I think that no matter what, somebody can look at your report. If you are abusing donors' resources that have been contributed to your campaign and you are converting them for personal use, which under federal law is a crime, that anybody in the Commonwealth of Virginia ought to be able to make that point and, make that observation and go after you for taking your family on a cruise with your campaign money. But in this case, it was drawn more narrowly, and it was drawn narrowly for a reason, because I think that there will be lots of people who legitimately will have concerns, and they will believe that somebody who wishes to attack them or go after them will nitpick, and there will be some concerns about how broad to draw the bill.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would just see if there's any appetite among the committee to do it so that it's what I would say has a little bit more teeth, because if the only people who can complain are people who already give you money, if it's truly if you could drive a Mack truck through, I would guess they might complain, but if it's bad and you're doing it, I think it should be able to be investigated.
Well, I'll tell you, I actually was concerned about that piece. Well, but here's what I would say. If I was concerned about that, and then I thought it through, and I thought, well, if you legitimately were looking to raise the point and you felt like you were somehow going to have an issue there, you go online and make a $50 contribution.
I would.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
That's true.
Right.
Madam Chair.
Right. I'm curious to know what other people think about that piece of it.
In a utopian society where everyone was altruistic and fair and honest, some of these things that are in the bill would not be subject to misuse. But in a rough, nasty, dirty campaign, there will be complaints. There will be line items that people will look at and they will say, there's something wrong with this. And I'm making my complaint 3 days before the election and we're going to the next one. And you'll see it happen. And that's the concern, quite honestly, that I have by setting up the
Adam, let me just tell you, there is a 30-day provision in this bill. Let me just clarify before you get there. That is one of the issues that's raised, and it's raised in many states, and one of the reasons that people have some heartburn. This bill includes a 30-day window beyond which you may not go after a candidate for that very reason. You can't set somebody up, have a staff person go out and run up a bunch of charges or pay something, and then have somebody come in and lob a complaint and catch them off guard. That is the underlying issue. As somebody who's sitting here right now who recently was set up, I can tell you we all face that exposure all the time. You can have a staff person who goes out and does something. You can have somebody who's an opponent from an opponent's campaign who sets you up. So, these are all legitimate concerns and legitimate issues. So at the end of the day, that's not likely to occur. You're not likely to have that happen. This is the kind of situation where you don't want somebody And it happens. It's happened in lots of states where, you know, somebody has run for office, used the resources of their campaign because they didn't think it was an issue, totally inappropriately and illegally, and in the course of conversion, converted those resources for personal use in a way that was egregious. And what we want to do is create a very clear, bright line that in Virginia, we do not tolerate that.
Madam Chair, I agree with him, and I want someone to campaign, but how about that crazy press? Press that's as bad as anybody else. And let me say for an example, some of you can remember, if last time, they had me in the paper, they had the money ringing out of my head, and they said that how can I live off of spending money, live off of $17,000, whatever you get, and say I never had a job. And I said, don't white people crazy. I said, that's wait a minute. So I'm big headlines. Say I never had a job. I'm retired from Verizon, 30 years. I get a Social Security check. I get a check for the campaign. And here, but they didn't print that. So the man said, you want them to retire. I'm 70 years old. And they would say, but they didn't print that. They had all the big headlines. They were saying that I live in the Lush Hotel in Richmond. I live at, London Road. And I said, I'm spending $3,000. My job as vice chair of the Democratic Committee was that if everybody paid their dues, we gather up money and we can have all the done. The press put all of it in there. And you check into it, fine. And I said, hey, you're so right. But they can put it in the paper, fine. But whatever for candidate can use that against me, you see. So that created the press that I'm concerned about, that you said.
Well, let me respond to that point, because there's a fundamental issue of the optics of something or what someone might write about or someone might accuse you of. But what you fundamentally have in Virginia is, in addition to, we're all adhering to an ethics rule, that we will not use our campaign funds for personal use. That's the law. I'm just passing this to make it clear that's the law. But you have this other piece of this, and that is we also have strict reporting requirements and transparency. So whatever you put on your report is what you put on your report. So you have control over what your receipts are and what your disbursements are. So as long as that's true and you're following ethical standards, there's no ambiguity there. What we're saying is that what your receipts and what your disbursements are going to be consistent with what the law is, and you're truthfully going to report what your disbursements are. And in Virginia, in the Commonwealth of Virginia, we are not going to embrace a set of standards that include the opportunity for campaigns or candidates to spend that money on themselves. That's it.
Madam Chair.
Senator Peek.
Yes. I agree with the whole principle that you were putting forward here. My concern is there are roughly 14 of us. We've had this for what was filed Friday, 8 days ago. I mean, there's been no discussions, not mentioned in the press, not mentioned amongst our colleagues. I don't know any of the rules for the other states. I know that I do not spend any money. I do not know anybody that does. But they publish all these reports on these personal things. But it goes back to the Governor's Ethics Committee. I mean, that went through a commission and a committee and was looked at and discussed by everybody. I feel like this kind of sprung on me 7 or 8 days to vote on. This is a very serious issue and a very important issue. And I think it should be discussed by a lot of people. And looked at by a lot of people and addressed by a lot of people and covered in the press. And none of that has happened at this point.
Madam Chair, can I also? Well, yes, and I will just say I'm happy if everybody would like to have more of an opportunity to look at it. I don't know how much discussion or debate it had. It has been heard in the other body. Not that that's irrelevant by any means. But I will say if you all would like to have more of an opportunity to look at it and look at the definitions, I will tell you that it is very narrowly drawn compared to some of the other bills that have been proposed in other states. Senator Chase?
Yes. Thank you, Madam Chair. One of the things that I would just like to make a note of, having run a number of campaigns and being political director for a number of statewide candidates and congressional candidates, sometimes people unintentionally use their personal card if they have multiple cards and they all look alike. And so a lot of times what will happen is the candidate will realize they accidentally use their card. And then they panic. They're like, oh no, what do I do? And so then the treasurer has to go back. They have to, you know, fix that. But if right now we are very transparent as most people know they can go to VPAP, they can go to State Board of Elections, they can already see where the monies are spent. I think this, I mean, I definitely honor what you're trying to do here, and I support transparency as co-founder of the Transparency Caucus. I think my concerns are the unintended consequences of the bill, and what will happen if someone, and for instance, my, you know,